All right, everyone. Good afternoon. Today is Tuesday, August 10th, 2021. This is the Salinas City Council meeting. Masks are required for all individuals regardless of vaccination status. This meeting is being conducted consistent with State of California Executive Order N-29-20, dated March 17th, 2020, regarding the COVID-19 pandemic. City meetings may be observed live on the Salinas channel, on YouTube, or on our website. If you wish to make a general public comment or comment on a specific agenda item, you are encouraged to attend the City Council meeting in person. Public comment is also available by email for this meeting. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance. Councilmember Osornio, would you lead us? Okay, thank you very much. We'll go ahead and do roll call. City Clerk.
Councilmember Barrera.
Here.
Councilmember Cromings.
Here.
Councilmember Gonzalez.
Here.
Councilmember McShane.
Here.
Councilmember Osornio.
Here.
Councilmember Rocha.
Here.
Mayor Craig.
Here. Excellent. Public comment. Public comment time restrictions. Public comment generally is limited to 2 minutes per speaker. I may further limit the time for public comments depending on the agenda schedule. General public comment, we are now open for general public comment on items that are not on the agenda and that are in the City of Salinas' subject matter jurisdiction. Comments on consent, consideration, and closed session items should be held until the items are reached. And it looks like we have somebody who's excited to be at public comment. Welcome, Mayor.
Honorable Mayor Craig and distinguished member of the City Council. I'm here this afternoon representing our Ichiki Kushikino Sister City Association. I am the chair of the board of directors. And I'm here to introduce a young lady, and she's going to tell you a little bit about what she's here for. But I'd like to just give a little background about her. She is one of our ambassadors that we sent to Japan representing our sister city, Salinas and Ichiki Kushikino. She is a recent scholarship winner from our association. She recently graduated from Notre Dame High School. She was a valedictorian of her class. She's been accepted to University of Southern California in freshman's honor pre-med. So at this time, I'd like to introduce you to Catherine Hodges.
Hello, Mayor. Good afternoon, City Council and Mayor Craig. My name is Catherine Hodges, and over the course of this past year, I have created a website for the Salinas Ichiki Kushikino Sister City Association. I have done this as a part of my Girl Scout Gold Award, the highest possible award a Girl Scout can achieve. This award must be a sustainable community improvement project that can be developed and changed past my involvement in the project. I just wanted to say that the Sister City Association has given me so much as a 2019 student ambassador. I was able to go to Japan and experience the culture that was there, and it absolutely changed my life. I was so thankful to the association for everything that they have done for me that I wanted to give back to them. So I decided to dedicate my project to them. I wanted to give them an online presence so that way they could share their information with the community more readily. So that way, the next generation of high school students could also experience the experience that I had and continue to grow this cultural knowledge in the Salinas community. I just wanted to thank you all for your continued support of the Salinas Ichiki Kushikino Sister City Association. And I wanted to let you all know that the website can now be found through the Salinas City website under your Sister City page. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. Okay, public comment? Welcome.
Good afternoon, Council, Mayor, members of the public, Nona Childress, District 3. I would urge you to publicize specific criteria which would lead to the re-implementation of Zoom participation. Online participation is a disability access issue. And I do thank you for the mask issue. even though that's a barrier to those who require speech reading. But please make some very specific landmarks when that would be reconsidered, whether it's required by local or state emergency orders, data on usage and the demand for it, or rising case counts. Please bring back the Zoom participation option, including telephonic for those who have limited internet access. Thank you.
Members of the council, community members, I work with a group called HUF, Homeless United for Friendship and Freedom. I'm from Santa Cruz. We face the same crackdowns on those struggling to survive outside. We face the same shadow of eviction for those unable to make rent in spite of makeshift extensions riddled with pro-landlord exceptions. We face the same failure of rental funding promised but never delivered. We face the same political pretty talk, politicians eager to return to a profiteering normal for landlords, developers, and business owners. This, whatever the consequences to poor people, whether inside or outside. Here in Salinas, yesterday and today, dozens of displaced urban residents had their makeshift survival homes destroyed and the property there callously torn apart, bulldozed, and dumped. Two survival encampments, Sherwood Park and Carr Lake, were demolished. Homeless people were threatened with destruction of their belongings as well as their lodgings. All this happened in a city that is clearly in violation of the federal court's Martin versus Boise decision, in spite of millions appropriated for homeless services. In the midst of a continuing COVID crisis, the Delta and Lambda variants threaten faster transmission, even among the vaccinated. Ripping homeless people away from their distanced outdoor camps is unwise, herding them into group shelters even more so. Sunny promises made by the Salinas City Council are contradicted by abusive practices by a city manager, mayor, and police chief that have returned to a whack-a-mole strategy at the cost of broader health and safety of the entire community. Apparently, the only way to stop this dangerous juggernaut is to make it too costly, either through lawsuits, as Chico and Novato have done, or through direct resistance. Waiting for those in power to develop a conscience is usually a fool's errand. Take direct community action.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm not ready. Good afternoon. I'm not ready to tell you, but I seen the meeting open, so I thought I'd do it now. I was arrested in 2017 on a domestic charge that I was the victim. He was the abuser. I got arrested. And the Salinas police took it all the way down to Monterey to his boss's house, Peter Davy. Peter Davy does all the projects for Salinas police. Then after that, I needed my truck back. Well, they gave it to him. They said it wasn't mine. That's auto theft from the Salinas police. They would not give it to me. So I had to leave, came back. I had to get my head straight. What was going on? I made my report the day I got out of jail. Nothing. Then Salinas police and the women's crisis, or I don't know what it is, that got him his legal status here with 10 DUIs and driving under the influence of cocaine. And then after that, the sheriffs helped me get the truck back. Then they didn't know who I was. And then they got to know who I was and what the police had done. Because the DA is the one that withheld the 911 recording from the court. And I had the 911 recording because I asked for it. And Amy Ramos, the supervisor, she did her protocol and she gave him a week. The DA never responded. But then when they found out that I had the 911 recording where it states that I was a victim, even the mayor, the last one that he died, he read it. And he goes, well, I hope they arrested him. And I go, no, they arrested me. Then after that, I got sexually assaulted on camera on a highway patrol. Now I want to make a formal complaint on that and then the district attorney says, I've never been arrested. Wrong. My fingerprints and everything. One goes to the state, one goes to the FBI. There it shows
Thank you, ma'am.
I was arrested.
Thank you. If you'd like to step outside and perhaps talk with, I think, Acting Chief Felice.
I did last time. I'm still waiting for the last one to call me.
He's right here. And if you want to go ahead and step outside, he will go ahead and speak with you directly. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Francisca Sanchez. I had been employed with Salinas Valley Memorial Hospital for the past 35 years. We're here today to speak to you about our bargaining. We are currently under bargaining contract, and we have been bargaining in good faith, which our SVMH has not. Management has proposed takeaways to our health insurance that will make it harder for employees and their families to access care. The proposal includes deductible increases, out-of-pocket max increases, and increased copays and premiums to our members. And we're still in the pandemic. What is very troubling to me, it was the way the hospital is seeing their employees. We had been through a pandemic. It was very scary for us. It was very scary for me at the beginning when we didn't know what was going on. We didn't know how to protect ourselves. I didn't mind. I put my PPE, and I was out there, frontline worker, helping my patients. On the last bargaining, the attorney said that an employee that is sick is of no value or service to the hospital, therefore they should not be accruing sick time at all. That, to me, it was an offense. It was a slap in the face, because we're out there caring for patients. We're getting sick. We're taking this to our families. We're trying our best. But we're still out there, frontline workers. And we do what we need to do to care for our patients. So we're here to ask that the board, the city, the mayor, the city council, please call our board of directors and tell our management team that is bargaining with us, to bargain in good faith. They're doing takeaways on every single item of our contract, which has never happened before. We're asking for your help in calling the board of directors, in calling the management, and tell them, please bargain in good faith. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, good afternoon. I'm Patty, and I'm also an SVMH employee. I'm gonna yield my minutes to my coworker.
Hi. Ma'am, we have 2 minutes per speaker, so you have 2 minutes.
Okay, 2 minutes total.
Thank you.
Okay. Hi, my name is Patty Rivera. I'm an occupational therapist at Salinas Valley Memorial Hospital, and I have been working there for 15 years. As therapists, we advocate for our patients every single day. I see my colleagues go above and beyond to advocate for their patients and their future. Today, I'm standing here before you to advocate for my colleagues, for the staff. We are in the middle of a pandemic, and as we try to regather our strength to face yet another surge, we are having to spend time in negotiations. We did not want to be in negotiations, and now we're in the middle of this. I have sat in these meetings, and I'm very disappointed by management. They have the staff there waiting for hours. They say, we're going to be here in a certain time, and 1 hour passes, 2 hour passes. The staff is there in their free time. As a therapist, I wish that staff could focus on their job. That way we can focus on the community healing. And instead of us focusing on programs and ways we could help the community heal, we're having to stand here before you in negotiations. I'm very disappointed. I've been there for 15 years. I like my job there, but I've been impressed by the staff and how they've been brave and worked with patients, and I haven't seen the same for management. Thank you.
Thank you. 2 minutes.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. My name is Keen Chakwanet. I'm a political and community organizer with the National Union of Healthcare Workers. And I'm just here to echo the concerns that have been relayed to you by our members at SVMH. It's been a very difficult year for our members. We represent about 900 employees at Salinas Valley Memorial Hospital. And over the last year and a half, my understanding is that almost 1 in 9 of our folks there contracted COVID, many of whom brought it back to their homes and infected their families. So when we're in bargaining, I want you all to appreciate the gravity of the protections that we're trying to win for the workers there, and also understand why they're so frustrated at the takeaways that they are coming up against at the bargaining table. At our first bargaining session in June, we were told that, you know, we're not going to make too many changes to the contract, that things will be, you know, pretty similar, and that we're expecting this to be pretty straightforward. But instead, what our members are finding is that they're only getting 2% raises year on year, and that management is looking to double copays, double premiums, things that will actually make it harder for people to access the healthcare that will keep them safe if they do contract COVID for a second time. This has been an extremely difficult series of negotiations. We actually went to them in good faith, I think it was back in February, saying, look, we don't want to have to deal with a contract in the middle of this pandemic. We just want to push this forward a year. That was rejected. When we finally got into a place after our preparations where we could bargain a contract in June, they weren't able to meet with us for 3 weeks. We had 2 weeks of bargaining, after which, for the final two weeks of July, leading up to the expiry of our contract on July 31st, they were unable to bargain because members of management were on vacation. So our members who normally get their raises on August 31st do not have the contract protections that actually, or the contract that would allow for that to happen. And when we said, look, can we get a retroactive raise to August 1st, which is what we've had in the past, we were told SVMH doesn't do retro pay. So now our members are bargaining, and our hope is that you all will reach out to the SVMH Board of Directors and also management to—
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Let them know that we need to settle a fair contract. Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome, Mr. White.
Hello. Wes White, co-president of Salinas Monterey County Homeless Union. Of course, there's been quite a rash of sweeps ever since California reopened. I remember hearing in the beginning of the year how, you know, oh, give me a chance from the city manager, and, you know, everything's on the table, yet we're still just doing the same old thing. Nothing's really improving, but there's a lot of carnage. You're about to sign another $2 million for cleanups, and it's like, are you like how are you going to do things different? You know, if people are already signing for services, you know, you're calling beds, which is weird. It should be for the whole city, and it's about housing, not shelter. And those beds, like at the Victory Mission, you still got to leave during the day. So how is that a bed? And you got to live inside a bag. You know, that's why people don't go there. You know, and it's in Chinatown. Everywhere it's focused there, so a lot of people don't want to go there specifically because that's the neighborhood they need to stay away from. You know, they have issues. They cannot be there. Yet that's where they're directed to go. And since you don't want to go, here's the carrot, now here's the stick. And we're much more happy with this one than actually trying to provide those services and follow through. You know, what are we actually doing here? What is our intention? Because we're spending all our money first. Makes me think of at the beginning of the year when we gave the police a raise, you know, and voted for that first, and then we're going to talk about, you know, the budget, the rest of the budget. But that bargaining unit got picked first and got most important and headline privilege, and that money is cinched. You can't touch it. So now there's no money left for anything else. Running water, electricity is what folks need for health and safety. If that's what you really worry about, is the health and safety, the rats and stuff, we can mitigate those issues. We can talk to people. Like I said, they're already signing for services, so does they have a case manager? Where's their case manager? Do they ever show up? Hardly ever. So come on, do it right. Stop faking it. Stop the sweeps.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Councilman. My name is Enrique Saavedra. I'm here just to say thank you for the recent work you've done at Sherwood Park. I think it goes far to help address the homeless issue. I, as a resident, appreciate that we're able to open the parks up and our streets. I think to address the homeless issue, we need to get the homeless folks in the right place to get the right attention, the right services. You know, there are citizens as well, just like myself. But again, I'm sure most of the folks who are homeless need either mental support services or substance abuse services, and they need to be in the right place to get the help they need. So again, thank you for that work, and please continue the work. I think it's the first step in trying to address the overall homeless issue in Salinas. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
My name is Nicholas Whitehead. I am one of the people who helped form the Regional Alliance for Progressive Politics, which was the vehicle that brought Bill Monning and other progressives into state government. This homeless problem is endemic throughout the area, but different cities treat it differently. In Santa Cruz, they're currently tolerating large camps until they develop a better plan. They're not trying to overturn people's survival equipment. That seems to be a rather brutal approach. There may be factors I don't realize. I'm outside of that. But I want to point out that Governor Newsom, when he first came to power, said that the solutions to homelessness should be regional. He doesn't like separate jurisdictions doing separate things. I think we should hold ourselves to that model and hold the governor to the model and supporting regional solutions. You can't avoid expenses, and and governments should cooperate, truly ambag maybe. I myself am the author of a plan called Project Engage, in which the business community and the substantial organizations of voting citizens and neighborhood groups get together to work out some of these solutions. We need some public works programs for people. We need purpose. We need to help homeless people develop purpose in groups, families, and individually. So it's kind of a triage thing that's needed. I'll leave it there, and I'll be helpful towards your city council. If we succeed in doing any of this in Santa Cruz, I'll come down here and I'll share with you those results.
Thank you. Do we have anyone else for public comment? Yes, sir. You can come forward. That's fine.
Hello, I am Mr. Stoll. I just wanted to comment on my visit to the sweeps that have been going on. It's a national problem that it's hard to set blame on any one person or group of people, whether it's the people in Chinatown or the people here behind the table here. I do wish that we had, as citizens, more insight onto what all the services are that are available. I think it's, as a casual observer coming into it, I'm finding a lot of things that I think the average citizen doesn't really know about and probably should know about. So I just encourage the council to adopt as much transparency as they can and to provide the services that they're saying they're providing and that those are actually working for people. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. All right, last call for public comment. Seeing none, I will go ahead and close public comment and also just publicly acknowledge that if you did send in public comment by email, it has been received by the city clerk.
Can I?
Hi, I'm sorry, I was busy reading. Come on up.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Hi, my name is Berenice Gonzalez. We own the El Volcan Taco Truck located in Salinas, California, and also represent the Union Food Truck of California. And we come in because we, all the vendor publics, we worrying that we don't want to change the ordinance, and we are worrying, and I make you support. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, we'll go ahead and close public comment now. And I do want to just acknowledge that if you did email in your public comment, it has been received by the city clerk, the entire city council, the mayor, and has officially been entered into the record. So just for all of you to be aware of that. All right, we'll go ahead and close public comment and we'll go into administrative reports. We will start with 21-340, Litter and Debris Subcommittee Update. And we have our city manager, Kerrigan, here to report.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm very excited to introduce this item this afternoon. when I started the interview process to become the city manager, this was the topic that we talked about. And then certainly after I got the job in January, I had a chance to talk to each of the council members about it. Was asked to put a subcommittee together, and I don't sit on a whole lot of subcommittees, but I actually chaired this one on the staff side of it, and I got a chance to pick my team. And I'd only been here a short period of time, and so I looked around at the people I enjoyed working with and I thought were pretty talented, and I summoned them to a meeting on a Friday afternoon to talk about trash. And I think the first meeting they came to, they looked at me kind of funny, like, what did they do wrong? We've had a number of meetings. We're putting the program together. We're going to have a formal press conference in September to officially roll out the program. But we wanted to come here this afternoon, give you an idea of what is Amor Salinas. You're starting to see the T-shirts. We're going to start getting them out to the employees. We'll be wearing them on Fridays. We have 15 partners, and I would like to read off the list. You're going to get a presentation from Sophie Rome and Jose Ariola here in a moment, but it's important to me because I called each one of these partners and I barely finished asking the question and they said, yes, we want to be a part of this. And so just real quickly, it's Smith & Enright, the Downtown Streets Team, Monterey County Water Resources Agency, Caltrans, Republic Services, Salinas Valley Solid Waste Authority, Union Pacific, the Faith Community, the Chamber of Commerce, SCCIA, SUBA, the Farm Bureau, Monterey One Water, and ACE. And the last partner that I want to just talk a moment about is the Salinas City Elementary School District. I could talk about any one of these and talk at length about our partnership with them, but I sat down with Dr. Rebecca Andrade early on, and we started talking about ways we could work together. Now, five school districts here in town. It's impossible to work with five school districts. So I said, I'll work with you and it'll be a template for all five school districts. So we sat down and started talking about a number of different issues. We got to Amor Salinas and I invited Sophie Rome over to sit with us. And Sophie walked her through Amor Salinas. And then after the meeting was over, well, Dr. Andrade jumped on board right away. She said, we want to be a part of this. And she represents 14 schools, over 8,000, 8,200 students. And so with this program, you're going to see three parts to it. The first part is volunteers, because volunteers are the only way this is going to work. So we don't want hundreds of volunteers. We want thousands of volunteers. And this whole program is going to culminate at Earth Day next April of 2022. We're going to have a citywide cleanup. So you're going to hear about volunteers. And the second leg is you're going to hear about a plan. We need to get into our parks and into our neighborhoods. So you're going to hear about that today. But the most important piece, without question, is the education piece. Because we can clean it up. We just got to get people from stop throwing things on the ground. So it's the education piece. And we kind of modeled after recycling. 20 years ago, nobody knew where the aluminum can went. It just went in the garbage. But today we all know which can it goes in. So we want to do the same thing. So we're going to start with younger guys, you know, third, fourth, fifth grade. And we're working on a plan. We have nothing in writing. We're just working on how can we get into the schools and work with our children and educate them. And they'll educate the parents. And then we're all going to stop littering. So I figure it's going to take us 7 to 10 years to get there, but we're starting with Salinas City Elementary School Districts, and it'll be a model that we're going to take to all the school districts. I'm going to stop taking all the thunder away from Sophie and Jose because there's not going to be much left of their presentation. But with that, if I could just introduce Sophie Rome, and you can lead us through your presentation and hand over to Jose when you're ready. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, City Manager Kerrigan, and good afternoon, Mayor Craig, council members, and Mr. Callahan. So I am very excited to share this information with you and tell you a little bit more about Amor Salinas. But before I get into what this program is about, a little bit of background. In February of this year, Mayor Craig had formed the Litter and Debris Subcommittee, and the primary purpose was to address illegal dumping issues and just overall beautification across the city as we were starting to see more litter and debris accumulate. And through our subcommittee meetings and the city staff working group, you know, we realized this is going to require us to increase our engagement, get out there and talk to the community, educate the community, but also to really grow our partnerships, because this is not something that the city alone can do. This is a community issue, and and challenge that we can all face and overcome together. So we really approach this looking at what is the long-term solution that not only addresses the issue today, but really puts us in a better place in the next 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, and, you know, and onward. And this is going to be really accomplished through education, volunteerism, and really taking ownership and pride in our Salinas community. So with that, the Litter and Debris Subcommittee members were Council Members Gonzalez, Orsonio, and McShane. And City Manager Kerrigan had put together a nice interdepartmental working group of city staff. And by pulling together staff from various departments, it really allowed us to analyze the issues and look at them through through different lenses. Each of us sort of address this issue or view this issue through our different departments in different ways. And so it really brought everybody to the table and really looked at the issue globally. So currently we do have some efforts that are ongoing to address litter and trash in the community. So we do receive reports through Salinas Connect. And so as issues are reported, city staff goes out and addresses those, whether it be illegal dumping or whether it just be items that were left on the sidewalk or the public right of way. And then we also have the work alternative program, and then our regular routes that are where litter, debris, and those types of issues are addressed on a regular basis. So what is Amor Salinas? Amor Salinas is really a commitment for us to do our part. And when I say us, I'm not talking about us as the city, us as individuals, us as Salinas residents, us as community members. So by wearing these shirts and supporting Amor Salinas and showing our amor por Salinas, it's a way of saying that we care and that we're taking pride in how our community looks. So as part of this process, we're working on developing guiding principles that can be shared with the community and really be a framework for community members if they want to lead any Amor Salinas initiatives independent of the city or in partnership with the city. Either way, we're here to support and to do our part. So Amor Salinas is built on two pillars: community restoration and community resiliency. Community restoration focuses on cleaning and greening initiatives. And I do want to point out that when we say cleaning, we're not just talking about picking up trash. It's how do we make our city beautiful? So that also includes things like public art and finding opportunities for more public art installations, painting of trash receptacles. And then greening initiatives, community gardens is an example of how we can, plant fruits, vegetables, flowers, and really lift up an area just by implementing a new community garden. And then Girl Scouts, I know you may have seen on social media recently, came out and planted several trees within our community. Another example of another partner organization really taking the lead on greening and beautifying our community. So community resiliency is also a really important element of Amor Salinas because, as City Manager Kerrigan pointed out, you know, we can't do this without the community. So how do we engage our community? How do we educate from young to our seniors, you know, on the things that they can do to help encourage, that spirit of volunteerism and getting out and doing their part? And in addition to that, we do have ongoing volunteer opportunities. And so we're looking at how do we expand and grow that database, you know, not just limiting the database to our regular volunteers and groups that get involved. How do we reach those other groups that haven't traditionally been involved, but maybe it's because they didn't know that they can get involved or how they can get involved? So sharing that information with them. And then there's also the equity piece. We do talk a lot about that. And, you know, citywide beautification means that the beautification efforts have to happen all the way across the city, not just in the same areas on a regular basis. So it's looking at where are the cities conducting cleanup or beautification initiatives, and where our community partners are conducting beautification initiatives and where the city may be able to fill those gaps or maybe partner with a group that is in that neighborhood to give a little more love and attention to certain areas of town. So our stakeholders, they're everybody. Again, this is a community plan. It's a community project. It's not just a city project. So it's really important that we keep the community as part of this conversation. We engage our business community, nonprofits, and very importantly, our youth, because they are the future. They are the ones that are going to carry this on 10, 20 years down the line. And with that, I'm going to pass it off to Jose Ariola to talk a little bit more about neighborhood services.
Thank you, Sophie, and good afternoon, everyone. So we have a lot of new initiatives here, and I think trying to pull together a lot of our existing infrastructure and work on litter and debris, but also increasing our capacity. And how do we do that without adding bodies? And volunteers are a big part of that. And so we needed to figure out, okay, where in our existing services can we get more of that coordination happening? And neighborhood services is really a natural fit. It used to be called Neighborhood and Volunteer Services back many, many moons ago, and there were multiple positions there. But we have a neighborhood services coordinator who's doing some of this work, and so there was a natural fit there. Karina Silva, who comes after the great work Anna Ambris did, who revived that position, I think has improved our community liaison work with our neighborhoods. Is a resource to all of you and working with neighborhood leaders, and it can help coordinate volunteers and city-driven volunteer efforts, as well as the great youth programs we have, including Yagi and Camp Amor Salinas, which I'll talk about here in a moment. So we've had a volunteer program for some time, but it wasn't large scale. And as city manager Steve Kerrigan said, we want to get to thousands. So in a few short months, we have hundreds now of registered volunteers, and these are people who have volunteered already. So it's not just people who are thinking about it or might like to someday. They've already put in hours in our parks and on our streets doing various volunteer projects. And that took some work because we had to figure out how are we going to scale that up? How do we make that accessible? And one of the great lessons we learned during the pandemic was how to engage our residents virtually. And that's a lesson we're going to continue to build on because I think all of us, whenever we're going to do anything, register for a new class, look for a new class, find a new resource, an event, we go to our phones, we go online. We need to meet people where they're at. And so we looked at what we have already to help volunteers find volunteer opportunities. And we used an existing program that we use right now for youth sports, and it's called Civic Rec. And so volunteers can now register online. So they never have to come in, they don't have to fax anything over, download a form, they can do it all online, which is very convenient and has really allowed us to build our volunteer database really quickly. We also promote all our opportunities on social media, through our website and our various newsletters, which is again, how people are finding information. Karina's done a really terrific job of marketing these opportunities. I think we've built really, really quickly. We also are a resource to all of you and resident leaders in helping support cleanups that originate out of neighborhoods, right? You got a few neighbors that want to get together, they need some supplies, they need to schedule a trash pickup. We can help with that and are trying to bring that to scale as well. And we've done that for a few of you already this past few months. We were really excited to get to be the first to use this new logo, this new marketing. With any movement, it's great to be able to have a tagline, a banner to fly under. And Amor Salinas, I think, is a beautiful one. I know that it's a very special idea. You hear the Love San Jose or San Jose Love, and various cities use the Love moniker. It's beautiful. I think we've had Loving Salinas before. But Amor Salinas is really unique and I think captures the spirit and the multiculturalism here in the Salinas Valley. And so I'm really excited that with the Amor Salinas Community Service Camp, we got to make these shirts. The kids wore them with pride. And we had 30 participants sign up for this camp. It was a brand new idea. We know there was pent-up demand from high school students who needed to put in hours to be able to graduate. And we took advantage of that. When we made this registration available, it filled up in less than 24 hours. That's never happened for one of our youth programs. We're really excited about that. We had a long wait list. 30 participants at the end of the day and over 600 hours of community service. If you haven't seen the horseshoe pits in the dog park lately at Natividad Creek Park, they look fantastic. They're well painted, and that's due to this great group of young people who came out and worked with this awesome staff over here, our neighborhood services coordinator and our Vistas here that we have, Rada and Capri. We're also bringing back the Adopt-A-Park program. We're really excited about that. There are a lot of groups, and many of you know them, that want to be a part of the solution. They want to do more than just come out for a couple hours. They actually really want to take ownership of a space. And so the Adopt-A-Park program is something I'm working on right now with our director, our LCS director, and we hope to bring it back by September. We've already taken a few passes at some of the language and the application packet, and hopefully can go live with it soon. And that way we could bring that opportunity. And we already have groups that have been asking about helping and being more involved in some of our parks on an ongoing basis. And we could really use that support. You guys know the size of our parks maintenance team versus the number of parks we actually have. So we could use all the help we can get. And how do we use citizen power to be part of that solution? And these new Revive Volunteer efforts, along with things like Adopt a Park, will help get us there. We have a really robust social media platform across various departments. If all of you aren't already following us, please do so. Those of you listening to the public, if you're interested in finding out about more volunteer opportunities, like us on City of Salinas at Facebook and Instagram. Follow us, please. We do our best also to join groups and things like Nextdoor to go to people and get and make sure they're informed. But if you see something come up and you can share it, we'd really appreciate that. We know a lot of you as council have a lot of followers as well. The education and engagement campaign, that's the real change happening, right? When we're getting into young people and engaging them, and so they start changing their habits around litter and debris. We're really excited about that. And then, of course, building to that thousands of volunteers for Earth Day 2022 is something we're really excited about as well. And we're going to get there. It's going to be a wonderful big day event. Now, Sophie and I will take questions.
Mayor, if I could, just one last quick comment. If you're around me at all, you know that I never went to city manager school, and I always said if I was going to be a city manager, I was going to do it my way. And my approach has always been find out what the assignment is. In this case, the assignment was come up with clean up the city. That's mayor over and over and over. Clean it up, Steve. And came all seven council members, clean it up. So, again, I got a bunch of smart people in the room. We left our egos and titles at the door, and I said, we got to come up with a program. And what's really neat is I'm going to identify one team member here, and her name's Radha Dahanakar, and she is one of our Vista employees, and she's on this committee with a bunch of people that have been doing this for 15 or 20 years, and she is one of the biggest contributors to this whole program. I want to say thank you. So we're making a better widget with each one of our meetings. One Saturday morning, I'm driving around with Councilmember Orlando Arsonio, and we're talking about it. And I said, what's the one thing you want to do before you, at the end of your term as an office? And he goes, I just want to clean up the town. I want to clean up the Isle of Sal. And I said, we talked about Love Hayward, Love San Jose. And I said, explained the program to him. And I said, what do you think? And he goes, I only have one request. And I said, what? And he said, can we call it Amor Salinas? And that's how the name was born. So with that, we'll take questions or comments or your thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, City Manager. I will go ahead. This is an informational item only. There's no action required, so I'll go ahead and start to my left with Councilmember McShane for questions.
No questions. I love the name.
Councilmember Rocha? All right. Councilmember Cromines? Excellent. To my left, Councilmember Gonzalez, questions? Councilmember Barrera?
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Mr. Arriola, Ms. Romo, and everyone else, congratulations. I think this is fantastic. Mr. Arriola, as we build morale, you know, the city manager just acknowledged a young individual here as doing phenomenal work in our community. With Amor Salinas, how is the city going to let go, and I'm talking about administration, just let go and allow the community to make it happen? And this is my question, because when the community gets involved and they're allowed space to do things out there, that's when positive change happens. So how are you going to build morale, because you have hundreds and eventually thousands of volunteers. How do you see that happening? Because it, when we build morale, people want to get involved even more.
So how do we get out of the way, Councilman, is what I'm hearing you say. And I think first building those relationships with all these youth and neighborhood leaders and resident leaders, right? And establishing a system where people feel empowered to do these cleanups and make them happen more often, and building our capacity to support that, right? I think, you know, and be upfront with neighbors about, well, this is you could what you could do without us, and this is what you could do with us. Both options are available. Don't let us stand in the way. Yeah. And so that's all about communication and developing those relationships. And we're well on our way to doing that, I think.
Thank you. Mr. Ariola, with the neighborhood beautification grants, do you see these? I know as people are applying for these, do you see this taking effect as well? Because I think it's what, like $50,000, I mean, or how much is it?
$56,000 is available this year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I, you know, we didn't make it part of this particular presentation because those grants could take all kinds of different forms in terms of neighborhood improvements, not necessarily around the litter and debris. But I certainly can have an impact and could help neighbors organize on bigger projects.
Great. And Mr. Ariola, I just want to, I think the morale booster, I think this is a great where when you have individuals doing some positive thing, especially like maybe writing a proposal when they get a grant. Just one other, because I want to make a question out of this. How are we going to hear those names? You know, like we heard one name right now. How are we going to hear, you know, so-and-so is doing great work? Because that just builds it up. Yeah. What's the plan on doing specifics, you know, when somebody's shining in our community and really doing some good work?
We don't have anything concrete yet, I'll say that, but it's always something we keep in mind. For example, with our camp, you know, though we didn't bring the kids here, they all got recognition, they got certificates, they made connections with some of you, they all met Steve. You know, it's about building those relationships, right? They know they can go to any one of these three young ladies for a letter of recommendation. So I think people are being seen and feeling like, wow, their work is valued and their volunteerism is valued, but we could certainly do more. And I think we could, you know, if we're having this many volunteers, are we recognizing volunteers on an annual basis? Maybe that's the next step we go. But we'll build that as we build our capacity.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Councilmember Barrera. Councilmember Osornio for questions.
No questions, but I'll have some comments. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. We'll go out to the public. Do we have any members of the public that wish to comment on this item? Mr. White, thank you.
I'm pleased and impressed it's so big and, you know, so well received. I do find a little bit of disappointment with, you know, I mean, we're spending $2 million on Smith and Enright when they could actually be taking care of a lot of the landscaping trash issue, especially as related to homeless as well. You know, we actually did a little cleanup around quite a few places years ago, you know, and it's like for that recognition of like, look, we're trying so hard to just be able to stay here, you know, and beautify the area, curb appeal, definite issues. And if you, I don't see why you're asking for grant money, begging for grant money when you got $2 million that could be better spent taking care of that, you know? So again, our attention, you know, and the folks outside, they're more than willing to help with that. If we changed our perspective on how we chose to treat people, you know, and allowed, well, your curb appeal, so we're going to skip you. You're a blanket of trash, so pick it up or else I'm going to notice you. We could take care of people better. And I think a lot of the trash would be mitigated, and the community spirit and camaraderie of, you know, everyone in town, your residents, especially the ones outside. And I think that role modeling of their behavior will help the general public's behavior as well as our role models in example, because you're the one telling us what to do and how to do it, because this is the best way to do it. We should be trying to gear and direct our attitudes and behaviors in congruence. And I see a lot of dissonance in what I'm talking about here, you know, the sweeps and let's clean up. You know, it's always for the little people, and that's not the way it should be. We should be, this is a community, it takes a village to raise a child, even those folks outside, and where's our compassion?
Thank you. Do we have any other members of the public that wish to comment on the Amor Salinas presentation? Okay, seeing none, we'll go ahead and close public comment. I'll go back to my left for final comments. Councilmember McShane.
Yeah, very excited about this report. Thank you, and the efforts to the city manager. Way to take it and run with it. And to the mayor, because you deserve a lot of credit on this as well. It was a commitment you made early on, very public about. And certainly to my committee members, it's exciting. This is incredible. When I first moved to Salinas, there was a young lady named Cindy Rogers that ran the volunteer unit. There were thousands every day, it seemed, pouring all over Salinas. It was awesome. The year was 1999. and it's just good to see us headed back in that direction. So, yeah, definitely in support. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember McShane. Councilmember Rocha, final comments.
I was born in 1999. Okay. So I want to thank you and your team because you're making a huge impact and you could see it. I went out to one of your cleanups here in Natividad Park, and oftentimes I think people think of cleanups as a chore, but all of your volunteers there saw it as a fun activity, and you could tell everyone is having fun, everyone is excited. And subsequently, I ended up doing a cleanup in my own neighborhood, and I was worried about how many people were gonna show up, that I'd be like three of us there, and that was gonna be it. But I had a lot of people show up to my cleanup, so there's definitely a desire to do these types of projects, and I'm excited that we're doing it in a manner that is most reflective of our city's diversity, not only the name, but in the parts of the city in which we are focusing in. So I really want to thank you all for your strategic efforts, and I look forward to seeing everything you're going to accomplish.
Thank you. Councilmember Cromines.
Well, I'm really bummed that I didn't get to be part of this subcommittee, because I think this is a great program you guys have put together. As everyone is probably aware, I'm intimately have knowledge of what the inmate crew coordinator does, and know that, you know, he and other members at the Public Works do a lot of work picking up trash around the city. And the thing that he says over and over again is, what happened to the days when citizens took pride in the city and in their property? We get so many phone calls from citizens that somebody dropped trash, you know, in their, you know, right of way right there, you know, the parkway between the sidewalk and the street, and they want the city to come pick it up. When it's, you know, it's not a shopping cart, it's not something of size, it's very, you know, very doable for you to go out and pick it up yourself and put it in your own trash can. And I think it's time for us to get back to a time when we can go pick up our own trash in our own neighborhoods and help beautify the city, because staff certainly, even if we had, you know, 50 park workers or people picking up trash, they're not going to be able to be everywhere all the time. So I'm really excited about this program. I think you guys did a great job, and I love the name. So thank you, Orlando. That was a great addition. Thank you, Madam.
Thank you. Councilmember Gonzalez, final comments.
Just thank you to everyone involved in the process and the entire initiative. I had the great pleasure of going to look at and see a cleanup of the community garden and Natividad Creek Park, and it was great to see so many youth involved and engaged. You really are starting to see a shift in the culture and a real empowerment into what it is to be a steward of the land. I appreciate the equity lens in particular in ensuring that really underserved public spaces now have the attention that they deserve. And I look forward to seeing how we can recognize our volunteers ahead of time.
Thank you. Councilmember Barrera, final comments.
Again, Mr. Ariola, to you and your staff, congratulations for this good work. Mr. Kerrigan, several years ago, and I know you're on your seventh month or eighth month But several years ago, we were at a meeting in Chinatown, and it was developed by people that are homeless out there. They came up with some great ideas on how to govern themselves, and the city didn't go anywhere with it. I thought it was one of the most best meetings I had ever attended, community meetings. And we were talking about litter and debris. Well, there's people out there that choose to live in a tent for whatever reason. That's they want to live that way. But there's a lot of people that keep a clean tent that would like to be part of the solution. And I think we need to bring them on board because they want to be part of the solution. Let's get everybody, like Mr. Arriola, you said, we want to get everybody involved. Well, there are people out there that want to volunteer. You know what I love about Salinas? And I like how it says Salinas. It doesn't say districts. You know, it says Salinas, the entire city. We have a city that a lot of people want to be involved in making this a great place to live. And I think this is a great opportunity. So, Mr. Kerrigan, I'm going to ask you, however that may look, because I know it's work, there's a group of people out there in Chinatown that want to be part of the solution, so I think we need to invite them. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Sornio, final comments.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Yes, Jose, Kristen, your whole team, I mean, I've met a lot of the folks that have been putting the pieces together. Every single time I speak with them, I'm sure you guys can all feel my excitement. It is something that when I first started running for to be an elected official, it was something that was, you know, while I was walking these neighborhoods, I saw a lot of litter and debris. I'm born and raised in Salinas, and so I know that this isn't the same Salinas that I saw years ago, but I'm excited to where we are today to be able to have a collaborative effort with Mr. Steve Kerrigan. Me and the mayor have spoken numerous times about litter and debris, and to see all of us working for the same goal, I think that that's what it's all about. Us as electeds, our constituents, our city staff, we all have the same goal, and that's to improve Salinas to what it was before. Hats off to everybody, all of us council members, city staff, and the community for really showing up. I try to make it out to as many of the events as I can, and I can't wait to volunteer for more. So again, thank you so much, and I look forward to seeing all of the new improvements. Thank you.
Thank you. I just a couple of quick comments for me. I took a phone call at 3:12 from a constituent who wanted to just acknowledge that there are, I know that we are really actively engaging our youth in a more Salinas. He gave the suggestion, he's a teacher, he gave the suggestion of Key Club and Interact, that are service-oriented high school clubs that have community service hours and have a network of high schoolers that can also engage and participate in that. So in terms of staff direction, I would just ask that you explore that opportunity. I know that you know it's said on the PowerPoint youth groups and whatnot, but I would certainly take a look at some of those service-oriented organizations in high schools, because they certainly have an obligation to do community service for us here in this community. I do just want to acknowledge when all of us, you know, in this past election were elected, that was a real topic of discussion, was how the city had just become dirty. And I use that word very specifically. It's not about, you know, beautifying the city by putting flowers out. The city had become dirty. And what I had discovered is that oftentimes the discussion defaulted to our unhoused population, and that the blame was being put on our unhoused population. And I don't think that that is the sole cause of why our city has become the way it has become. So it was really important for me, through the conversation with our new council members, and really to determine that the council really separate the two discussions. We have an obligation to provide services and to provide opportunities for our unhoused population, but we also have an obligation to keep our city clean. And so, therefore, it's really important to make sure that we understand that a more Salinas is not about the homelessness, but it's about cleaning up the gutters on Sanborn. It's about garbage along Baranda. It's about adopting our parks and really making sure that we can bring pride back to our city. So with that, I just want to say thank you for your excellent work, and I'm thrilled that we have momentum behind it. Thank you.
Thank you. Could we bother you for a quick picture, if you wouldn't mind just standing, so we can get all of you in the great
t-shirts? Of course.
Just standing at your seat before we go. Thank you. You get one too.
And if you guys feel so inclined, you'll notice in some of the pictures. One of the things that we're doing in terms of marketing, and you'll see in our pictures, is that we're doing the heart hands. So if you'd like to do heart hands, feel free.
Thank you.
Trying to keep a layer of professionalism with a sport coat, but really it's nice and toasty up here, so I'm going to go ahead and ditch the sport coat. I think others will too. With that, thank you, and we'll go on to our next administrative report, which is 21-302, the 2021 Monterey County Multi-Jurisdictional Hazard Mitigation Plan Update. And we have Battalion Chief and Fire Marshal Skylar Thornton with us. Welcome.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Mayor, Council. I would like to just very briefly open up with, we are one component of Monterey County in terms of our hazard mitigation plan, so this will be an overview from our representative from Cal OES, who will go through our role in how the city and our services that we have and our hazards that we potentially face, how we'll deal with those.
Thank you so much. Hi, my name is Kelsey Scanlon. I'm an emergency services planner for the Monterey County Office of Emergency Services, and I'm here today to talk to you about the 2021 Monterey County Multi-Jurisdictional Hazard Mitigation Plan. I know that was very lengthy, but before I get started, I just wanted to say how impressive it is to have a jurisdiction within the county that is just so forward-leaning in your vision for the future. And it, I think, is reflected in the comments that you've received from the public, as well as the presentation that we just received. And I think that what I'm about to present really goes hand in hand with that vision that you've already set forth. So what I'm gonna talk about is generally what the hazard mitigation plan is, what it means to you, and the overall planning process and the next steps. So ultimately, the hazard mitigation plan is your long-term vision for how you want to reduce risk to your communities. And typically, people think of this in terms of natural hazards, so earthquakes, fires, floods, but it also encompasses long-term vision that can be applied to human or technological hazards. But ultimately, what we do is we take those hazards that you've identified within your community, and we look at how you want to address them by identifying specific strategies that you can actually implement. Not just the broad vision, but your actual strategy for reducing risk. So the hazards that we cover have expanded since the 2007 and the 2016 plan, to include agricultural emergencies, coastal erosion, dam and levee failure, drought and water shortage, earthquakes, flooding, landslides, severe weather, tsunami, wildfires, climate change, sea level rise, public health hazards, technological hazards, and human-caused hazards. The previous iterations focused primarily on natural hazards. There we go. So the way this can come about is in the form of a variety of different activities. Most commonly, people will associate hazard mitigation and risk reduction with physical projects that you can see, the ones that are tangible. So seismic retrofitting of buildings, elevating homes above a floodplain, restoring a natural wetland. But there are other strategies that can be placed without requiring a significant amount of resources, whether financial or otherwise. And those are looking at your policies and strategies for expanding or building within your jurisdiction. So if you're moving into new areas, how to best navigate that space so that you're not increasing risk while you're developing. You can also look at outreach, like having community emergency response teams. There's so many different strategies that you can tailor for your jurisdiction. So ultimately, the city of Salinas is part of the countywide effort to collectively update our hazard mitigation plan. All the cities could do it independently, but it's within the purview of the Monterey County Office of Emergency Services to recognize that hazards don't care about political subdivisions. They all affect us equally. We saw that with pandemics, and some more so than others, but for the most part, hazards don't care if it's in the unincorporated area of Monterey County, and we all have a collective vision for reducing risk. And so our office has been coordinating that effort. In an additional effort, not to give you a cookie cutter county specific plan, we have an annex for the overall plan for each city. And so the city of Salinas has their own appendix that is very specific to your community, and it's about your vision and it's about your goals, and it identifies your specific mitigation strategies that you want to implement over the next 5 years. And so it's organized by identifying your community profile, your current land use and development trends. It does a city-specific risk assessment. It identifies your capabilities to reduce risk, and then identifies areas that you'd like to improve, and then actual actions that you will plan to take place over the next 5 to 10 years. So having said that, we had originally started this project in January of 2020, right before the pandemic started, which was super useful for us. So obviously that was put on hold until very recently. And so we have been conducting community outreach throughout the event. We held 7 public outreach meetings in January of 2020, right before the shutdown, which was kind of fortuitous, actually. And then since then have been steadily updating the plan, reviewing all of the content, and adding a lot of stuff that we felt was relevant, not just to the unincorporated area, but to our local jurisdictions as well. This plan is intended to go out to our stakeholders for review in November of 2021, and then out to the public for review in January 2022, at which point it will go to Cal OES for review, and they'll, in theory, give their approval pending adoption. It then goes to FEMA for review, and then it comes back to the local jurisdictions to adopt as a city and county policy, and then we get FEMA approval. Why do we care about FEMA approval? It's because with an approved hazard mitigation plan, the city and the unincorporated areas of Monterey County are eligible for FEMA hazard mitigation grants. Without this plan, you don't even have the option to apply. So there are a variety of ways people can get involved. And the first is we have a website. There is a public survey for people to take. And then there's the option to download and review the plan and submit your comments. And people can either pick it up in person, or we can mail it to them, or they can request it of their local jurisdiction as well. But ultimately, we make this available for everyone to look at and to have a vested interest in providing comment for that vision. And so with that was a very succinct and pithy version of this. I have my colleague Laura Emmons' contact information as well as mine, and we are more than happy to answer questions or provide guidance.
Thank you, Ms. Scanlon, appreciate it. Did you have, I'm sorry. Okay. with that, we'll go to council members for questions. I'll go to my left, Councilmember McShane, questions.
No questions, thank you, Kelsey.
Thank you, Councilmember McShane. On to Councilmember Rocha. No? Yes. Councilmember Cromines? To my right, Councilmember Gonzalez.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Quick question, Ms. Scanlon. When we do the public outreach, the survey, the website, will that material be available in English and in Spanish?
It is, actually. The survey is in both English and Spanish, and our website, unfortunately, it does use Google Translate, so it's not the most accurate, but that is available. And then once the plan has been finished, we are planning on having the full, like, 300-page document translated into Spanish.
Awesome. Thank you.
It's very exciting. It's the first time this plan has been translated, and I could not be more jazzed about it.
Very glad to hear it. Thank you.
Councilmember Barrera, questions?
Madam Mayor, just questions, no comments.
We'll go back for comment.
Thank you.
Councilmember Osornio, questions?
No questions. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. We'll go out to the public. Does any member of the public wish to comment on this item? Seeing none. We'll go ahead and close public comment. I'll turn to my left for final comments. Councilmember McShane, Councilmember Rocha, Councilmember Cromines.
Thank you.
Councilmember Gonzalez, final comments.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Councilmember Barrera.
Ms. Callan, thank you for your work and the work of your staff. I know this is critical work. And we're always hoping and praying that we don't have to go into some serious emergencies, but I'm grateful that we're prepared to take care of a business when there's serious issues in our community. So thank you very much.
Councilmember Osornio, final comments.
No comments. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. I just will acknowledge a few years ago, I went through a master's program that talked about natural disaster as one of the homeland security issues. And certainly the Office of Emergency Services plays a significant role in that. I'm thrilled to see that we have expanded that discussion because normally, you know, for years, the issues were wildfires and earthquakes and sort of the standard disasters that occur here in California. But really, we do need to be looking at agricultural emergencies and coastal erosion. That's a very real thing in this community. Dam and levee failure, certainly. We have seen flooding as of late. So just to make sure that we are fully prepared. I'm thrilled that we have this to be able to bring forward, and certainly makes us eligible for grants with FEMA. That's a great thing. So thank you for your work.
Thank you for having us.
Okay, next up, my favorite topic, 21-304, the 2021 fireworks season after action report. And we have Battalion Chief and Fire Marshal Skylar Thornton again.
Thank you again. In case you weren't aware, fire season is officially closed as of July 15th. Technically for me, it opens in February and then it will close at the end, I guess, of this meeting with the delivery of this report, which will summarize briefly the steps we have taken over the past several months to try to help mitigate the fireworks problem that everyone is aware of that we have in our community. So this was a collaboration between Salinas Fire, Salinas Police, Public Works, and Mag One Media, as well as our friends at Community Development with some of our code enforcement officers. We contracted with Mag One, which is a local media company, and they helped get us off the ground with increasing our social media exposure, which, as everybody knows, that's the way to get your word out if you have some sort of platform that you're trying to communicate to the masses. And they were very helpful. I'd also like to thank Chief Clement for laying out kind of the groundwork and helping get me through this first year, because he was extraordinarily helpful, so I can help get things rolling for delivery. Seemed to have a little. There we go. Here is what our city website looks like with our text and voicemail line, so that it also has a link to Salinas Connect, and this is what people would see for the over 1,000 complaints that we received. Most of this information was either taken off of the city website or through our social media, print, and radio ads that we had this year. Stats-wise, for funding to pay for our enforcement efforts, comparison from 2020 to 2021, our application fees received us about $7,500. The surcharge for the fireworks brought in $74,000, and what we have sent out in administrative citations this year compared to last year was substantially up. After our subcommittee meeting with the council, we determined that the marching orders were to send out as many citations as we could and to try to make this inconvenient and over time try to change people's mind, because if they realize that they're going to have to go through an administrative hearing to pay a bunch of money for their 4th of July celebrations for illegal fireworks, maybe over time they will do less of that, and that will make everybody's life a lot better, because we have a lot of people with pets and former service members who 4th of July is not a fun holiday at all for them. And so we're trying to make the community safe for everyone. This is a quick breakdown. Our two vendors, TNT and Phantom Fireworks, politically, this is a great fundraising opportunity for community groups. We take 18 every year, 18 winners out of a lottery. We have about 40 applications typically, and our winner this year was North High. They raised over $40,000 for school supplies, athletics, and without this opportunity, you know, that really puts a damper on these groups' ability to raise money. So while we advocate for the safe and sane ones, they are not the ones that are leaving the ground. They're not the ones that are going boom in the night. So this is what we regularly get the question of, why do you sell fireworks and yet you're not happy with fireworks? And there is a fundraising component and there is a enjoyment factor, and then there's the illegal ones that we're trying to mitigate. So for us as the fire department, we track statistics pretty regularly. We ran almost 2,000 calls in a month and a half. And although I don't have the structure fires lined out, we didn't have any that were specifically related to fireworks. But we, as you can see, we had a number of vegetation fires related to fireworks and other miscellaneous fires related to fireworks. So typically, year over year, those numbers have consistently gone up. Our brothers in blue worked extra hard on the 4th of July from 4 p.m. to 1 a.m. We had six officers and a sergeant, as well as a CSO, and they were out on patrol in marked vehicles. They were working with us with real-time information from our text line, voicemail, and Salinas Connect, getting the complaints out, as well as they were fielding a number of 911 calls on the 4th of July. And so they received 84 calls or complaints for fireworks between 1600 and 0100 hours that they responded to. They issued 13 citations and then responded with the fire department on a number of other calls. So we're grateful for their support and couldn't do this without them. So here's a little bit of information with our Salinas Connect. We had over 1,000 complaints, which is up dramatically from last year. I think that's in direct correlation with our social media campaign. And we understand that, you know, this year, 4th of July fell on a Sunday. So Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, it's game on, let's do this. And so we had increased enforcement primarily on Sunday, but we were observing and reporting as well. Starting well before the 4th of July, we knew that this year would be one for celebration because things were opening up from being locked down for the better part of a year. Here's a little video clip of some of what we observed and reported, and this is the basis of some of our administrative citations. So again, we'd like to thank the Code Enforcement Division, who helped with 4th of July enforcement and driving around in unmarked vehicles and observing and reporting and helping us gather intel so that we could adequately and accurately get the citations mailed out. So we mailed out 251 citations ranging from 1250 to 2250. That's per fuse lit. So if we saw multiple fuses lit at one address, then they would get citations in increments based on those numbers. So if you light 10 of those, that's a pretty big number. And to the right, you'll see that's an example of the administrative citation that is mailed out. So that's what people will receive in the mail, much to their surprise. Here is some our expenses year over year. As you can see, our outside services went up a bit because that was the increased scope with our MAG-1 media contract. And then we printed up several more signs, the 4x8 signs that you would see around town in both English and Spanish that Public Works puts up for us each year. So the overtime is fairly consistent between the two departments, and our grand total was just over $43,000. In the future, we're looking at some additional options for trying to mitigate this hazard as well, looking at the reward system, looking at trying to get some more undercover activity going in terms of, are we able to, through social media, maybe try to set up some sting operations and buy some illegal fireworks and catch them before they are sold out to the public. And then we would like to increase our relationship with the PD and try to get the use of the drones out next year and help pinpoint locations, because it's nearly impossible to pinpoint where fireworks are coming from when you're driving down the street and one pops off, and typically they're from a backyard, and then another one pops off behind you, and it's like looking for a needle in the haystack. Even though there's needles sticking out everywhere, you just can't find the origin. So, and again, our goal is to just change the social consciousness, the behavior of, let's educate people and make this inconvenient for using illegal fireworks so that everybody can have a good 4th of July, and over time, hopefully, we can bring down the level of war zone type environment that everybody goes through on the 4th of July. I know people would like to have a good time, but I think they can have a good time without aerial fireworks and things that are exploding and setting off car alarms. Any questions? Try to be as brief as possible.
Thank you, Chief Thornton. I appreciate it. And I will start to my left with questions. Councilmember McShane?
No questions. Thank you, Scally.
Councilmember Rocha?
Just real quick, the funds that are generated from the citations, well, do we actively pursue the citations to generate that revenue, or?
This is our first year with this volume of citations, and so we will be working with legal, and we will be trying our best to pursue these citations as best as we can, as well as for some of them perhaps coming up with some options of, if you have a big fine and you would like to perhaps do a public service announcement about the fireworks enforcement program and say this is a real thing and I'm sorry and I recommend that my community members don't do this, we would be willing to entertain that idea.
And where does the funds generated from it, what, are they going to go into the general fund?
They have in the past, yes, and I would assume that they will continue to do so, although I may advocate to try to help our enforcement component and try to put some of that back for us for next year.
Okay, know. Those are all my questions. Thank you.
Councilmember Cromines, questions.
I had served on the fireworks committee briefly and am no longer on it. So when I was, we discussed a couple of options. One was having a fireworks show, and would you know, did the fire department feel that that would lessen the amount of illegal fireworks, you know, and using the money from the citations? I mean, that's one of the ideas there, because, you know, coming up with the money was one of the issues. So that's one of my questions. The other one is, have we ever thought of, would there be a way to come up with safe zones to try to get them out of their house and away from doing illegal fireworks?
I'm not sure I follow your safe zones. Well, is that a specific escape route?
Like we used to, many moons ago, I'm going to age myself here, there used to be a grass field out at Fort Ord that you went to, a band played out there, and you got to go out there and set off your safe and sane fireworks. It was a big party, you know, very family orientated. Mm-hmm. But basically, it wasn't a city organized event. It was just a safe place to go and set off your fireworks and be with other people. Have we thought of something like that? Is that something that's been discussed?
Not to my knowledge. However, I think there's a little bit of discussion of apples and oranges in terms of safe and sane fireworks can be set off anywhere. Right. The illegal ones, we don't advocate even a safe place for that, because they're illegal fireworks. They leave the ground, and we had more than one person this year, again, lose a hand or a component of a hand, and because of illegal fireworks that leave the ground, and the wick is not as long as they think, and there they are, minus some fingers or more.
So has the committee given up on us doing something like at the rodeo grounds?
No, I think that's a very valid discussion that we can have. I know there has been fireworks shows in the past. I know they're expensive. If we weigh the financial component and do kind of a risk-benefit analysis, I think we can try to come up with a solution that might make that viable. And maybe that would reduce
our... So I put that in your ear now. There you go.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Cromings. To my right, Councilmember Gonzalez. Questions?
Yes. Thank you, Chief, for the presentation. If there's a slide up there, if we could get that back up, where there's the cost-benefit analysis, the comparison of 2020 and 2021. There's quite a large jump in the category that says outside services. What exactly is that?
That was what I referred to, was the contract with MagOne Media. That was our social media campaign where we embedded ads on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, Google tracking, with determining how many people are seeing our ads, how many people are clicking on our pop-ups, how many people are interacting with our anti-fireworks, anti-illegal fireworks campaign.
Gotcha. And when we think about how we best leverage staff, has there been any kind of discussion as to further use of advanced technology, for example, drones, in tracking? You mentioned that the needle in the haystack, where the origin of these fireworks actually come from.
That's our hope next year, is to greatly step up our drone use with SPD and be able to hopefully much easier pinpoint those locations, photograph them, and then we can send out a citation based on where we see the fireworks coming from.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Barrera, questions?
Thank you. You know, it looks like you're doing a fantastic job, so thank you for that. I know it's a daunting experience. You know, the Q Alert, Salinas Connect, I hear great things about it, then I hear not so good things about it. You mentioned we had 1,000+ complaints. How do we keep the integrity of Q Alert? Because I hear a few people saying, you know what, I don't even call them, or you guys don't even answer or respond, which is valid. But how do we respond to that, where people take their time to report something?
Mm-hmm.
Who's in charge of this, or who gets back to these people on the Q Alert?
The volume of complaints is such that we cannot respond to every one of them. And so it says right on, when you log into Salinas Connect, it says, do not expect a reply. There's also a short paragraph of the information we would like, who, what, when, where. and then it provides an area where people can input their explanation of fireworks at this address at this time every day. Persons wearing this saw a car with this license plate leaving this area, and then a bunch of fireworks went off, things like that. And so we're following up with those. We're forwarding those to the police department. And so all of that information is gathered, and we're doing the best that we can with the resources that we have in terms of trying to be timely with our responses to get out there. I'm sure it's not as timely as everybody would like, but all of the complaints that had verifiable addresses received a citation, and so the people who are making the complaints may not necessarily know that unless they talk to their neighbor and their neighbor goes, hey, guess what I got?
Yeah. If I could also add, we're going to take the information from those 1,000 complaints. I'm going to pull the curtain back here and show you guys what we do. We're going to take the information from those 1,000 calls and we'll create heat maps for next year. So we'll go right down those streets where we get the most calls for service.
And with that, Mr. Kerrigan, and this is just one big point regarding fireworks, but on other calls, I hear that we're way back. I guess my question is there a way that we're going to be able to make this thing better where, you know, we're putting out there, this is the way you connect with us, this, we're gonna respond, but people are saying, and again, you know what, it's daunting, it's no blame on anybody, but how do we give the integrity that, you know what, I'm calling and I'm sure I'm gonna hear somebody respond to me somehow?
Well, first of all, I think it's a good problem to have that 1,000 people are calling us saying there's an issue. And I do believe that the drones are the way to go. That's the next step to helping solve this problem, but it's a multi-year problem. We are, I'll be honest, we are overwhelmed.
Yes, I understand. So
we are gonna do our best and we just need to ask the people to have patience and keep reporting. We do keep all this data and we will use it each year, and hopefully at some point behavior will change, because this is, I mean, it's a rough situation. Yes. So.
And with your comment, Mr. Kerrigan, I believe behavior will change when I get a $1,200 citation. Guess what? I'm not going to do it again.
We hope so.
Yeah. So my last question, and again, you know what? This is not about blaming. This is just trying to understand how we can do a better service here. And I think we're going in the right direction. There's somebody out at Closter Park right now that I guess forgot that his 4th of July is over, but almost on a daily basis, bombs.
Yes.
And I hear about this beautiful project out there, the Shot Spotter. And it says, I told my wife, hey, the Shot Spotter is going to get that. They're going to get the guy. But then we hear the bomb again the next day. I think what concerns me is I start hearing dogs, you know, animals are in fear. So my question to that is, the Shot Spotter able to get, these aren't fireworks. These aren't firecrackers. These are literally bombs, illegal. Does a Shot Spotter get a hold of that?
That's a question for Chief Felice.
For the man.
He is the subject matter expert.
Give me a drum roll.
Good evening, member of the council. So Shot Spotter is actually able to discern whether it's a fireworks or it's actually shots being fired by a pistol. To answer your question, yes, it would be able to pick up that type of sound and assume that it's going to be a gunshot, so officer will get dispatched to it. And hopefully, you know, we'll be able to put a stop to it. If there are, but we always encourage the public to just call us so we can be, you know, be there before anything goes off and take care of it before.
Yes, thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
All my questions.
Thank you, Councilmember Brewer. Councilmember Sornio, questions?
No questions, Mayor.
Thank you. We'll go out to the public. Does any member of the public wish to comment on this item on fireworks? Okay, seeing none, we'll go ahead and close public comment and come back to council for final comments. Councilmember McShane.
Sure, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to be a part of the fireworks subcommittee. Several residents commented on how nice it would be to have a fireworks show. So I just want to throw that out there. And if that's not a possibility, and I see a couple of nods, I know we pulled it off 1 year, barely, and it was expensive, and the rodeo said, we don't want to do it again. But just, we'll throw that out there. Some sort of 4th of July celebration.
there were a couple people that sent me clippings from the newspaper and said, gosh, like Chular, Greenfield, Monterey, Sand City even has a pancake breakfast. So where is Salinas? We had nothing. Not that we need to do a parade or I don't know. But I mean, maybe we can do something for 4th of July. So just want to throw that out there. That's all. Thanks.
Councilmember Rocha.
Thank you. The only comment that I have, well, first is thank you for all your hard work and to everyone in your department and everyone that was out there on 4th of July. Just being a resident in the city, it, you know, and I hate using the term war zone, but it sounded really, really bad. And I was getting messages from constituents who were asking me, you know, what can we do about this? And I was sitting there thinking, I don't know, I'd stop, you know, talk to your neighbors, have them not, you know, set off fireworks. But I hope that the funds generated from that will go back some way into fire prevention or mitigation or something to mitigate the efforts or mitigate the impacts of these illegal fireworks. Those are all my comments.
Thank you. Councilmember Cromings.
So I happen to think that the 4th of July is one of the most wonderful holidays we have, and I love fireworks. So I'm probably the only one sitting up here going, man, I really hate that we have this conversation every year. I know that we can't have illegal fireworks, and I know that it's putting people in danger and that we need to do something. And I agree with Councilmember McShane. We as a city council need to start working now on maybe using some of these funds from the citation in doing something for the city that gives them something else to do rather than spending a lot of money. Illegal fireworks are not cheap to have their own party at home. You know, if we can give them something family friendly to do, then maybe we can get them out of the house, you know, something like the food and wine, which went over really well. So, you know, that would be the focus that I would want to take is looking at a fireworks show or some sort of festival that perhaps we could have.
Is that a buddy or a request?
That is absolutely a buddy if
okay,
you would like to
sure.
do it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Gonzalez, final comments.
Thank you very much for the presentation and all the work that is done on that day and all the many, many months before. As you said, it's not just the one night, it's a long, long season. I look forward to seeing how we were able to continue to mitigate this issue, as it's not going to be one that goes away overnight. And I'm definitely in support of having some kind of community event that would then serve as a deterrent and a proactive factor in how to address it. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Councilmember Barrera, final comments.
Yeah, again, thank you for your good work. I know it's a daunting problem that we have every year. I'm all for good time with family and the hot dogs, hamburgers, what have you. But we have a handful of illegal people that want to, and don't misunderstand what I just said with illegal. There's some people that don't want to be part of the solution. They want to continue breaking the law. And I think as we use those drones, like you said, we're going to be doing more. People that just don't want to be community members and want to continue doing what's wrong in our community. I think we'll be able to stop that because there's someone over at Closter Park, even now, it's been every day. This is really loud bombs. And you know, senior citizens get scared, animals, and that's serious. But it seems like that individual that's doing it or individuals doesn't seem to care. So we need to find a way how to cite that individual because it happened last night again. So I'm all for a good time. I just hope it doesn't cost us thousands of dollars because 99.9% of our population follow the rules. They want to save community. But there's a small handful of individuals that it doesn't matter how much education we give them, they're just going to break the law. Thank you.
Councilmember Sarnio.
Thank you, Mayor. I just wanted to give a thanks. I was given a invitation to go in for the 4th of July briefing where I had some incredible salmon well, see, now I can't tell you guys what it's about. You guys have to go next year, right, Clemens? So it was great, and I also wanted to give a shout out to the approach of our acting chief. hearing how you wanted officers to handle these situations, I really liked that, Chief Felice, because I still remember you saying, at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is we're going out there and we're making sure that we're keeping folks safe. They're obviously having a party. They have family members over. They have friends. And the last thing, you said it, the last thing we need is for you guys to engage and get into a back and forth with somebody that's trying to have a good time. Go out there, do what you need to do, document what you need to do, and get on with the way. So that approach was just, it was incredible, because knowing that even though they're breaking the law, we're trying to be as compassionate as possible when they're doing festivities. So again, thank you for allowing me to go to the briefing. And I know Ms. Councilmember McShane is notorious for doing third buddies and fourth buddies, but I want to be a buddy on the fourth of July show. I think it's definitely something needed, and we have some talented individuals here at City Hall that I know can make it so that this event is not us just throwing a bunch of money at it, but hopefully we can make it a fun family event that everybody could enjoy to discourage people from going out there and doing illegal activity. So I really want to see something come up, and I'm very supportive of a 4th of July show if the numbers look right. So thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Just a couple of comments. First and foremost, they're not too long ago, just a few years ago, we had zero citations issued for the 4th of July month. Zero. I mean, there was a point at which our city threw up their hands and said, it's chaos, you know, and we're busy going to other calls and doing other things to be addressing fireworks. I have to commend both police and fire for recognizing and understanding the amount of constituent complaints that we receive on how their quality of life has changed significantly between June 15th and July 15th. Based on the accessibility of illegal fireworks. Thank you. Recognizing that you have bigger fish to fry with your own respective jobs, taking this issue seriously and bringing it forward and coming up with creative solutions and figuring out different ways and deploying undercover vehicles like a Jetta and a 1984 Nissan truck. And I mean, it's really remarkable how you deploy to try to determine how to reduce that. And I also have to give credit, I think it's your office, city attorney who's sitting next to me and I'm having a brain freeze. Okay. As city attorney, your office is the one that's doing the administrative citations, if I'm not mistaken.
We are helping the fire staff this year.
Understood. So recognizing 251 administrative citations, I think will start to turn people's opinions as they receive those citations in the mail. It's really important for this council to remember that we need to start educating and changing the behavior of our residents with that. Lastly, I want to commend you publicly on your social media presence. I saw it several times, which was remarkable. I saw it on, you know, different channels, different social media platforms. It was a great plan, and having some background in that, I thought it was very beautifully executed. And lastly, I just want to acknowledge 14 fires from fireworks is up significantly from years in the past. I think we've had maybe two, maybe three, 14 fires due to fireworks. So it's definitely an issue that we should be very conscientious of and really keeping the focus on making sure that residents understand the consequences for illegal fireworks gone wrong. And I just will acknowledge, I was on council when there was a community show, having as part of, you know, my volunteer role at the Rodeo Association, I do know the Rodeo Association struggled tremendously with getting volunteers, because that's their worker base, getting volunteers to be there on the 4th of July, serving beer and giving tickets and making sure that, you know, people were in the right seat. So I while I appreciate the concept of a community event, it cost the city a tremendous amount of money. And if I remember correctly, we were not welcome back from the Rodeo Association. So we're going to have to be pretty creative with that if that's something we want to pursue. And it sounds like this council does want to pursue that. So with that, I will just say, Battalion Chief Thornton, you've done a phenomenal job this year. Great work for your first year. Certainly, Chief Klemek, thank you for your guidance and expertise and institutional knowledge on it. It was very well done this year.
Thank you.
Of course.
Cinder block tied around both ankles, and it was a lot for him to take on, but he did handle it beautifully. And to you, Council, for your support through all this, and the fireworks committee really coming together to help us out with doing this. It's been a good effort, and we'll keep marching forward. Thanks.
Thank you. With that, no action is required, just direction to staff, which I think they've received. We'll go on to the next item, 21-350, the NPDES mandate and liability. And we'll receive the report from City Manager Kerrigan.
Thank you, Mayor. Heidi's gonna give us our presentation. The city attorney and I will provide support. Heidi?
Great. So good evening, Mayor, Council members. I'm Heidi Niggemeyer. I'm the City Stormwater Program Manager. And I'm here this evening because I wanted to just tell you a little bit about our NPDES permit, some of its discharge prohibitions, and also the legal authority that the city has to address illicit discharges like trash. So just to start off, obviously we're going to have to talk about regulatory issues. So here's a little bit of a regulatory background. So the principal regulations that mandate and drive the city's stormwater program are the Federal Clean Water Act and California State Porter Cologne Act. And how this all came about was in the early 70s, the Federal Water Pollution Control Act was revised, and the resultant act ended up being the Federal Clean Water Act. And the EPA gave authority to the states to regulate NPDES programs. So it was very interesting that California already had its own version of the Clean Water Act, which was called the Porter Cologne Act. So a lot of times we're talking about being regulated by the Federal Clean Water Act, but it was actually California's Porter Cologne Act that was there first, which I thought was kind of interesting. Then there's also the EPA Phase 1 regulation, which requires municipalities that have populations greater than 100,000 people to obtain their own individual NPDES permits. So the Clean Water Act prohibits discharges of pollutants into waters of the U.S. from any point source, unless the discharge is in compliance with an NPDES permit. This applies to discharges from municipal separate storm sewer systems, or called MS4s, and these are typically your cities and counties, industrial facilities, and construction sites that are over an acre. Salinas is the only Phase 1 city in the Central Coast region. Cities that have less than 100,000 people in population are called Phase 2 municipalities, and those are like Hollister and Gilroy, and they have to comply with what's called the state's general permit. The State Regional Water Control Board, through its 9 regional water control boards, administers the NPDES stormwater permit program in California. However, it's Region 3, Regional Water Quality Control Board, that is responsible for drafting our permit and for enforcing it. So our NPDES permit was issued in September of 2019. And permits are usually on a 5-year permit term, so this permit will go until 2024, and we are currently in year 2 of our permit cycle. There are 19 provisions in the NPDES permit. 13 of these provisions, mandate that our program monitor and maintain stormwater quality. What's interesting is that this permit incorporated the state's trash amendments, which requires us to have 0 trash to our waterways by October of 2029. So here are a few excerpts from our discharge prohibitions. The discharge of trash to surface waters of the state and the deposition of trash where it may be discharged into surface waters of the state is prohibited. The permittee shall attain full compliance with the trash discharge prohibition, which means, again, zero trash to waterways by 2029. And these pictures are just some examples of sources of trash throughout the city. So we talked previously about how the city has a legal authority to address illicit discharges. What exactly is an illicit discharge? Well, basically, it's any non-stormwater discharge, and trash is considered an illicit discharge. As the runoff moves, it picks up pollutants, it carries them, and it deposits them into local waterways. Most of the stormwater in Salinas currently does not go to the wastewater treatment plant in Marina. It discharges to our creeks, to the reclamation ditch, and to the Salinas River, which all eventually end up draining to the Monterey Bay. So I thought I'd provide this picture. This picture is one of our water quality monitoring outfalls located on East Market and Division Street. And what's interesting about this, it's a 4-foot in diameter outfall. And to protect the monitoring equipment and to keep people out of the pipes, we put gates up in front of our water quality monitoring outfalls. And oftentimes, the gates are left up during dry season, and then in rainy season on October 1st, they're opened up so that flow can come through them. And we actually, last year, had an early storm, and so the gate was not down yet. So this gives you an idea of how much trash can be conveyed in stormwater runoff. And if that gate were down, all of that trash would have gone to our creeks. So there is a provision in our permit, our NPDES permit, that's called legal authority. And basically what it states is that we need to have ordinances, standards, and policies in place to be able to enforce our NPDES permit. We also need to make everyone that's within the city limits comply with the NPDES permit. And we need to have progressive enforcement response plans in place to address repeat or continuing violators. So here are some more of our NPDES permit requirements that were provided for your information. But I just wanted to stress that the Regional Water Board recognizes that homeless encampments are a huge source of human feces, trash, and other pollutants. Encampments along our waterways allow these pollutants to discharge into our waterways, which is prohibited. The city is required to take all steps necessary to prevent any non-stormwater discharge that could adversely affect human health or the environment. This is what's called our duty to mitigate, and it's in the provisions of our permit. And then another standard provision is what's called our duty to comply. So basically, the discharger must comply with all of the terms, requirements, and conditions of this order or the permit. Any noncompliance constitutes a violation of the Clean Water Act and the California Water Code, or the Port of Cologne, and is grounds for enforcement action, permit termination, revocation and reissuance or modification, denial of permit renewal application, or a combination thereof. So when we talk about enforcement actions, what kind of enforcement actions could there be? Well, you could have administrative orders or citations, which often involve monetary penalties, or you could actually have civil and criminal actions, which could involve jail time. This next slide I've provided for you is just a basic rundown of all of the potential penalties that the city could face for noncompliance with the NPDES permit. I just provided it for your information, so I'm not going to be going through all of them. But I just wanted to add that in addition to these penalties, the city could be sued by a third-party nonprofit. And these lawsuits are prevalent in Southern California and the Bay Area. Also in 2015, the city underwent an audit with the EPA and the Central Coast Water Board. So we're already on their radar. So the Central Coast Water Board received multiple complaints about the Casentini area. So the city manager and public works director were very proactive and did a massive cleanup in late July. So here's a photo of the area that was cleaned and all the property owners involved. It was about a 1.7 acre area. Private property owners were notified of the upcoming cleanup and the fact that once cleaned, they're responsible for keeping it that way. And the city has the legal authority to enforce that. The cleanup was conducted by the City of Monterey and the Monterey County Water Resources Agency, and the costs of the cleanup were split. Monterey County, as well as every city and county within the state of California, also has the same requirement for zero trash discharge to waterways by 2029. Monterey County Water Resources Agency is responsible for maintenance of the reclamation ditch, but the city is responsible for trash and debris that is deposited into the waterways, and the reclamation ditch is a waterway in the city of Salinas. So here's a picture of the area prior to cleanup. Just a few photos of, this isn't like the entire area, but there's just a few photos that I picked. And if you note the amounts of debris and trash that are right along the rec ditch, which is a city waterway. And here is the area after cleanup. So there were 23 tons of trash and debris removed, and the city's share of the costs was about $16,500. Although the area was cleaned, homeless encampments are already forming under the Main Street Bridge. Enforcement of our NPDES trash requirements is necessary. Camps need to be kept away from our waterways. We are reviewing our current policies and ordinances to determine whether amendments can be made to provide additional enforcement options. So that's it. Happy to answer any questions.
Heidi, thank you very much for the presentation. I'm sure there'll be a couple of questions. I just want to make a couple quick comments. Regional Water jumped on board immediately a few months back when we started talking to them. And I just like to personally thank Brent over there, their leader, fantastic partner. Thank you for everything you've done on this. We will be using the NPDES permit to go through all the waterways throughout Salinas. So it started with Casentini, yes. But we're going to go throughout the entire city and all of our waterways. Now, we had a concentration here. And we certainly have other places that are, you know, not as bad, but they're bad. But we're going to look at every waterway throughout the city. And then you made a comment about the homeless coming back, and that's been a question. I think the biggest concern we've had is we can clean it up, we can get people to go. How do we keep them from coming back? And that's where I'm asking Public Works, I'm asking our parks workers, I'm asking our outreach workers, I'm asking the police department, the fire department, everyone that's out in the field, they have to let us know when they're coming back so we can stop the homesteaders, because they cannot be in the waterways. That's an absolute. And I'm holding firm to that one, because as a holder of the permit, you know, we're responsible. And so the feds go to the state turn to us, and there's no one after us. And we are subject to penalties and fines. And we're not going to have that. So I'm going to be difficult on this one with anyone that criticizes us, because we are the holder of the permit. So, and it is the environment at the end. We didn't even talk about that today. That's a whole different discussion for another day. But this is the environment we're talking about. So, but thank you for your presentation, Mayor.
Thank you. Thank you. And we will go ahead and City Attorney, did you have anything you wanted to weigh in on? Okay. Then I will start to my left, Councilmember McShane for questions. Councilmember Rocha, questions?
Thank you. As part of the requirement for the permit, one of the responsibilities for the permit is to have zero trash in our waterways. And I recognize the need to keep encampments out of that area. What is a more permanent solution to it? Are we looking at a fence, some sort of a structure? Because say if we do the cleanups, people can return, and are we going to continue to spend $10,000 every single time someone comes back, or are we going to look at building a fence protecting the waterway area?
We looked long and hard at solutions like fencing, but the homeless have equipment to cut through the fences, and the fences are very expensive, and it's just next to impossible to fence this, any of the reclamation ditch or the waterways. It's just, and again, they have the tools to get
through. So the answer is enforcement. Okay. It's a touchy subject, but the answer is enforcement. And that has worked for some other cities in neighboring areas where they've been able to enforce sending out letters to private property owners, citing their ordinances, stormwater ordinances and getting them to actually keep their properties clean. So that was one step that actually works. And working on trying to enforce and keeping the homeless encampments away from the waterways, that would help as well.
The private property owners have been very good partners too. We don't address that, but they've been very good. But I think it's gonna take a good 6 to 8 months of just staying on it and staying on it. And then eventually I think the folks that have chosen to try to live in these waterways will realize this is not the place to be. It's not your home. It's a waterway, and it's just going to take a lot of that, and we're just going to have to stay on it. But I think, again, we're looking at about 6 to 8 months of that, and hopefully change some behavior and get people to realize you can't live in a waterway.
Have we looked at what other cities have done?
Yeah, I just provided that example. Yeah, no, Marina has done that.
Okay.
With the private property owners. But everybody else in the whole state is under the same mandate. Mm-hmm. So they're all trying to scramble to find out the same kind of things that we're working on.
Mm-hmm. Those are all my questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilmember Cromes? Councilmember Gonzalez? Councilmember Barrera? Sorry, I mistook that hand signal. Thought you meant you had two questions, not peace. Okay. Councilmember Sornio, questions.
Yes, I actually do have a couple of questions. So I know exactly where that waterway is. On the other side of Main Street, kind of like if you're going towards the Sherwood area, there is another waterway there. Being that we are responsible for waterways, are we responsible for all waterways?
All of the waterways within the perimeter of the city of Salinas.
So I know that the area of concentration on this this cleanup effort was on the Canstantini area, but if you actually follow that trail kind of going over, going to the Rossi area and then going quick across the street, mm-hmm. that also is an area that I think that there's a lot of litter and trash and debris in there. Was that addressed on this cleanup?
I don't believe so on this one.
No, it was not. I think it was really just the aerial photograph that you saw in the presentation. That was the area that we concentrated on at this point, but we're going to get there.
Yeah.
Okay, so that area will be addressed as well?
Yes, it will.
Thank you. I don't have any other questions.
I have a clarification.
Thank you. City Attorney, you have a clarification?
Yeah, and I have a clarification about something how you said. The city is not responsible for the waterways, right? The waterways are the responsibility of other agencies. We're responsible for things that get discharged into the waterways. It's a very, very important distinction.
Yes.
Because if the city assumes control of the waterways, you assume a whole lot more responsibility and liability and obligation. I want to make sure that it's clear of that distinction.
Thank you.
Thank
Chris.
You.
Okay. I have no questions, so we'll go out for public comment. Does any member of the public wish to comment on this item? Okay, seeing none, we'll come back to council for final comments. To my left, Councilmember McShane.
Yeah, I just want to recognize the city manager's commitment to this. Thank you very much, City Manager Kerrigan. I got so many emails on this, and it's not even in my district, and I'm sure Orlando will have some praise to share. This is an environmental concern, and I certainly stand with you in continuing to address this. Thank you, and thank you for highlighting this in the presentation. Thank
you. Councilmember Rocha.
Definitely, we're all on the same page that we need to protect our waterways. As we look towards addressing this in the long term, I hope that we continue to focus on utilizing the caseworkers as we go out into these areas to make sure that it's communicated. And I know that the first communication is not going to always be the most effective one, but continual communication with unhoused residents in the area to make sure that they don't come back to that area.
Councilmember Cromings.
Thank you. Steve, you did a good job there. You know, I got a lot of phone calls as well. This is exactly, Casentini is where Councilmember Ersonio and I split the baby right there. And it has been of great importance to us to get that waterway cleaned up. Because of the waterway and what we're dumping into the oceans, I've worked on stormwater for the last 20 years now. So I understand what we're up against and how important it is for us to keep that permit and that we have more obligation than some of the other smaller cities, and therefore we have to work even harder than they do on this. So I think it's important for the community to understand that smaller cities will get away with more than what we're going to get away with. We have more strenuous obligations than they even do. So keep up the good work, please. Thank you.
And to my right, Councilmember Gonzalez.
Just again, I'd like to echo everyone's thank you and praise of the collaborative effort that's being done here to take on this issue. It's not by any means a one-size-all-fit situation, so I appreciate your particularity in making sure that we do this not only as intentionally as possible, but as humanely as possible. And so I look forward to that continued outreach and to seeing what can be done to maintain that interdepartmental approach to tackle this from all ends. Thank you.
Councilmember Barrera.
Yes, thank you, Ms. Heidi. I'm always impressed with your presentations. I mean, this is, you're an awesome person. This city is blessed to have you. I mean that sincerely, because this is a critical, daunting, man, this thing is hard to understand. And going back to Mr. Kerrigan's word as far as criticism, well, we get criticized a lot, and it's valid. We don't have easy answers. But I hope that Mr. Kerrigan, as our new city manager, can develop the partnerships that we do have with the county and other smart people?
Companies.
Yes, thank you. Because this is about partnerships. This is daunting. And you know, I hear the word enforcement. Some people don't care if they go to jail. Or, I mean, what are you gonna do, make me pay a ticket? Some people don't have that. They can't pay a ticket. They can't pay a citation. But we're going to be held responsible, not only financially, but, you know, the environment. This is a serious thing. Mm-hmm. So I hope that we can figure out ways on how to be more proactive. So thank you for your work.
Thank you.
Councilmember Sornio.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor. These efforts that we're putting forth, I mean, I do need to give credit to Steve, our city manager, because having those partnerships is crucial. Mm-hmm. When we call, you know, Caltrans and we're budding with them, it's crucial having those partnerships. It's what's gonna take us to the promised land and making sure that we get a lot of these things done in a collaborative effort. I do understand that these waterways and the importance of them are waterways, and so I know that this is something that we had to do. So I just want to keep on saying, keep up the good work, making sure that these waterways are safe, having that discharge that's coming out of them, making sure that that's not polluted with all of these. You know, I think I went down there one time, and I want to say that I saw like a bed in there. And I mean, that's not where you dump beds.
No.
And so, tip of the hat to our city manager, and appreciate the hard work. Thank you.
And I have no final comments other than thank you for the report, Heidi, and very much appreciate your efforts.
Thank you.
All right, with that, we will go on. No action is required on that item, so we'll go on to public hearings. 21-347, Zoning Code Amendment 2021-003, and Ordinance Amending Chapter 37. Of the Salinas Municipal Code, modifying extended stay regulations for hotels and motels. And we have our Community Development Director, Megan Hunter, giving the report. Welcome, Megan.
Thank you so much. Good evening, Honorable Mayor and Council members. Before I begin, I just wanted to quickly introduce our new community development analyst focused on homelessness, and she's actually leading the Salinas outreach and response team, Keishla Lopez, if you could just quickly wave. So soon we'll get out her contact information to you, but since we were talking about outreach, I thought it was appropriate to mention her. So back to the code modifications for extended stay for hotel and motels. I think even this council now is probably familiar with the discussions that we've had and using hotel and motels for either employment, housing, or for even interim use, such as for emergency beds for homeless individuals. So just going back, we are looking at a zoning code amendment that would amend multiple sections in the zoning code related to commercial districts, mixed-use districts, the future growth area in the village center, the temporary use of land permit, and it would add a new zoning code section 3750.085. And this is related to extended stays. So just a quick background. The 2018 Salinas plan recommended that the city look at the use of hotels for this temporary use as a way to minimize displacement into the neighborhoods. The Farmworker Housing Action Plan for Salinas Valley and Pajaro Valley has identified the need for farmworker housing, both permanent and for the temporary H-2A workforce. And so in March of 2019, actually, I should say before that, the mayor at the time, Mayor Gunter, convened a subcommittee group of ag workers, housing advocates, labor contractors, and agricultural companies to discuss a solution for housing. And so we've been discussing this for now multiple years. We did put into place a temporary use that allows this through the temporary use of land permit process that was established in 2019. And this council approved an extension of that to 2021 to allow us to have a permanent fix to this issue. And this is the permanent approach that we're recommending, which is to amend the extended stay provisions for hotel-motel use. So real quick, as I mentioned before, this would be in certain zones, but it would require a conditional use permit to ensure neighborhood compatibility. It would change under the current ordinance for extended stay. Guests are allowed to stay for 6 months. This would extend it to 10 months. And this new changes, I think, actually adds a lot more teeth in terms of, like I said, management plan, security plan, parking minimums, and some minimum standards for open space. This change is consistent with many provisions of the general plan, including the economic element that discussed the need for housing for our agricultural workforce. And also, in many cases, these are low-performing, obsolete hotels that are being repurposed for this use. So it really actually has resulted in investment. We did also go to the Airport and Land Use Commission, because many of the motels are actually in the airport overlay, and the Land Use Commission supported the amendment. Under CEQA, this is exempt under two sections of CEQA, which are 15305 and 15061. This won't have any impacts. I mean, we're just mainly changing it from a hotel use to an extended stay with occupancy that is increasing from 6 months to 10 months. The proposed amendment aligned with investment as it relates to housing, addressing housing challenges, operational efficiencies, because right now the hotels have to apply for tulips every year, so it's a convoluted process. This streamlines the process, and it helps with public safety, as I mentioned, the conditions. And we also will be doing an inspection to establish this. And there was coordination among many departments, current planning, permit services, housing division, and I failed to mention, oh no, I did. The fire department also reviewed and provided feedback, and of course the legal department, as always. Chris Callahan gives us great advice on our ordinances. So there's always a question about how this might impact the TOT tax in our city. Under state law, you can't collect TOT beyond the first 28 days or after the 28 days of occupancy. And what we discovered when we had this as kind of a temporary use, we didn't see any real change to TOT. Actually, TOT kind of went up a little bit. So we don't think that this would have an impact on TOT because essentially those that are operating under the temporary use of land permit for the last three years continue to operate in this manner. And so my the recommended motion is to find zoning code amendment exempt from the California Environmental Quality Act pursuant to a class 5 categorical exemption and adopt an ordinance for zoning code amendment 2021-003. And I am available for questions.
Great, thank you. We'll go to my left, Councilmember McShane for questions.
Nope.
Councilmember Rocha?
Yes, I have one question. And we kind of touched on it briefly at the housing subcommittee meeting, and that was because it's not designated as technically farm worker housing, they don't have to comply entirely with some housing laws that are designed to protect tenants. So what are we going to do to ensure that someone doesn't get this conditional use permit and then put 8 to 10 people in one room? Because there's not that occupancy requirement as part of a hotel, right?
There's some occupancy standards because it is still operating as a commercial hotel. So there are life safety, and as I think as I mentioned as part of this process, but the fire department and code enforcement officer inspect and make sure that they have adequate evacuation plan, and that is part of the looking at that and making sure that they don't violate fire codes. Because a lot of times there, and I'm not the expert, but Sam could probably tell you a little bit more, but a lot of times occupancy is dictated by kind of the safety and security of the building. So I don't think you could fit in any of these rooms 8 people because of the need to have exits and ways to evacuate.
And is it a part of our conditional use permit? And I think you said yes, Chris, when I spoke to you, like a rule outlining how many people could be in a room or something like that?
It's so when we do a conditional use process, we actually circulate to all of the departments, including fire. So there would be, we would look at that to make sure it doesn't violate any building or fire codes.
Those are all my questions. Thank you.
All right. To my right, Councilmember Gonzalez. Councilmember Pereira. Councilmember Sornio?
No questions.
All right. We'll go out to the general public. Does any member of the public wish to comment on this item? Okay. Seeing none, I'll come back to council for final comment. Councilmember McShane?
No.
Okay. Councilmember Rocha?
I think it's a great idea to increase the number of units available for people, especially in our workforce. My only request is that we're hypervigilant on ensuring that, you know, everyone's providing a safe environment for the people who will use these units.
Councilmember Cromings, okay. Councilmember Gonzalez.
Thank you, Mayor Kirk. Just thank you, Megan, for the outreach, and I really appreciate that we're looking at taking this issue on outside of the box in any way we can and using these resources at our disposal. So thank you.
Councilmember Pereira.
Yes, Mayor, and Ms. Hunter, thank you for your report. And Mayor, when we're ready, I'd like to make a motion to approve the amendment.
Second.
And Madam Mayor, after after the meeting, maybe I'd like to meet with Chief Felicia because this is a needed service because we do have a lot of hardworking people that need a decent place to live. But it brings other domestic problems in our neighborhoods. And I think you would concur with me. And I just want to see how we're going to enforce certain issues. Because when you get a lot of single men, hardworking men, you get other things happening from the outside as well, other businesses, and I'm concerned about that. So thank you.
Councilmember Sorneil.
Thank you, Megan. Appreciate the report. My only ask is to continue, and I know the city already does a really good job of regulating the conditions inside of these hotel motels. I think that that's the biggest ask, because for our essential workers, our ag workers, we want what's best for them. And of course, affordable housing and just housing period is a challenge here in California and across the nation. But when we're getting creative and looking for alternative solutions for our housing crisis, I think it's a great option, and being able to extend the time and things like that that can be occupied. And be able to give these motels where otherwise might not be occupied, and be able to have some income coming in as well. So again, thank you. And I would just continue to say that we need to do our job in making sure that these are up to livable standards. So thank you.
Thank you so much for clarifying the transient occupancy tax, the TOT tax. I have been out of office for a couple of years. It was something that I had some significant concerns about when I was on council. Very disappointed to understand and learn that we can only collect up to 28 days of transient occupancy tax, particularly when our hotels are occupied. Obviously, that is revenue that's generated by the motel owners, and they are not paying the appropriate taxes that they would be paying otherwise if visitors were visiting the hotels and staying there for short term. That being said, I certainly understand that we are in a shortage of housing, particularly for our farm workers, and that's the price we pay for it. But would love to know if legislation changes in the future, something along those lines, that we can readdress that issue. With that, I have a motion for staff recommendation by Councilmember Barrera, seconded by Councilmember McShane. Please call for the vote.
Councilmember Barrera?
Yes.
Councilmember Crummings?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember McShane?
Yep.
Councilmember Osornio?
Yes.
Councilmember Rocha?
Yes.
Mayor Craig?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Excellent. Okay, on to the Salinas City Council consent agenda. And because we are in person with an audience for the first time since March of 2020, I'm going to go over a couple of acknowledgments about the consent agenda. To expedite meetings and reserve time for matters that need to be discussed, Salinas City Council has a section on their agenda labeled as the consent agenda. Items on the consent agenda are generally non-controversial items that do not require much, if any, discussion. For example, routine correspondence that requires no action, minor changes in a policy or procedure, standard contracts that are used regularly, final approval for proposals or reports that have been fully discussed and vetted at past meetings, and reports provided for information only. The consent agenda allows council to group such items together under one heading and decide them at one time. Discussion on an item should be limited to specific questions on that item after it is pulled. The consent item description is listed in the executive summary of each item on consent in the staff report the council has read and received. And staff, please keep your responses succinct and to the point. Thank you. And with that, I will go to my left to see if I have council members that wish to. Oh, thank you. We have a couple of updated items. Continued until August 24th is the second reading of the ordinance amendment to Article 16 of Chapter 20 of the Salinas Municipal Code on an ordinance amending Chapter 34 of the Salinas Municipal Code pertaining to mobile food trucks. And canceled indefinitely is ID 21-306, the no stopping zones at dead end streets, and ID 21-312, the 20-minute green zone designation at 316 Williams Road. There are 22 items on the consent agenda. I'll go to my left to pull. Any council member wish to pull items? Council member Rocha.
Just for clarification on what the purpose was for the indefinite, what's the term you used? Indefinite, you're not going to talk about the 20-minute zone?
I'm sorry, are you asking why it's being canceled indefinitely?
Yeah.
Do we have a staff member that wishes
Andrew's going to take a shot at those for us. Thank you.
Acknowledge that?
Yes.
Sure. Good evening. So the request for green zones is initiated by the resident. The resident submits an application to the city, pays a fee. We were taking the application through the process, and last week the applicant reached out to us and said she no longer wanted the green zones. The report was agendized, so it's still appearing on the agenda, but the applicant no longer wants them.
Okay, and the other one was on the food vendor, mobile food vendor? I'll ask about that separately. The only one that I want to pull was 313 Bronda Road Congestion Relief Project for questions and comments.
Okay. Okay, I'll go to my right. Council members wish to pull an item for consent?
Bronda Road as well for a quick question. Okay.
Councilmember Sornio?
326 and 325.
Excellent. May I have a motion out to the public? 303.
Motion to approve the rest of the consent agenda.
May I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Motion made by Councilmember Cromine, seconded, I believe, by Councilmember McShane on items 371, 295, 307, 311, 315, 316, 322, 329, 336, 337, 338, 339, 341, 344, 345, 348, 368, and 370. Hot dog. Let's call for the question.
Councilmember Barrera?
Yes.
Councilmember Cromings?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Osornio?
Yes.
Councilmember Rocha?
Yes.
Mayor Craig?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Excellent. We will go to the first item on the agenda. Go to the city clerk?
No.
It's to the public. Yes, Ms. Nona. City clerk's giving me, city manager's giving me bad advice up here. I'll go to the public, Ms. Nona.
No worries, we're all
I
running
I 303 for 2 minutes, please. Thank you.
Thank you. I wanted to support this amendment, and I am a dinosaur, I admit it. I like hard copy, but the interests of transparency for the public and the possible reduction in errors are strong arguments for this. And I want to give a shout out to the city clerk's office, who has always been supportive for candidates and their treasurers, and to specifically put that in the ordinance that they are available for those individual counseling sessions to teach the new system. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll need a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
All right. City clerk, ID 303.
Motion by Councilmember McShane, second by Councilmember Cromings. Councilmember Barrera?
Yes.
Councilmember Cromings?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember McShane?
Yep.
Councilmember Osornio?
Yes.
Councilmember Rocha?
Yes.
Mayor Craig?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. ID 313, we'll start to my left. Councilmember Rocha, Bronda Road Congestion Relief Project.
Thank you. There's $8 million available for the project or identified for the project and a $13 million price tag. How far are we going to get along with the $8 million that we're going to do? Where's the stopping point?
It is divided in phases. The phase one that would be ready will stop between McKinnon and El Dorado. And actually, the entire $8 million is for the entire project, because the entire Bronda Road project from Dartmouth Way to Independence Boulevard, because the $3.2 million on the fiscal impact from development fees is applicable to the entire length of the project. And I believe for the phase one, we are only allowed to spend $300,000 out of that $3.2 million from development fees arterials. So that's the explanation for that phase one work. The phase one, though, received the entire $4 million from the RSTP funds the Regional Transportation and Safety Investment Plan.
And how soon are we going to start the construction of the project?
At this point, the permitting would be about towards the end of the year. Really, it's the funding that we are having a challenge to complete the funding to start the project. Plans are now going towards 95% completion for the phase one, but the funding is still inadequate, insufficient.
Okay.
When we go to open bids, when the time comes, we will do the bidding process to see where we are, where that gap is, how far the gap is, and present to council a recommendation.
So what exactly am I approving today if there's insufficient funds?
You are approving the Boronda Road project from Dartmouth to Independence in its entirety for CEQA purposes. Normally, when we approve the project, we do this during plans and specs approval or award, but in this case, we're dividing it into phases. So we are asking for this project at this time to be approved in its entirety.
Okay. Those are all my questions.
Thank you. Councilmember Gonzalez.
Answered my question about which phase would be approved or not. Looks like it's as a whole. Thank you.
Great, thank you. And I'll need a motion to approve, please.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion made by Councilmember Rocha, seconded by Councilmember McShane, ID 313. Call for the vote, please.
Councilmember Barrera.
Yes.
Councilmember Crummings.
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez.
Yes.
Councilmember McShane.
Yep.
Councilmember Osornio.
Yes.
Councilmember Rocha.
Yes.
Mayor Craig.
Yes.
Motion passes.
ID 325, pedestrian crossing enhancements, the CIP 9188. Councilmember Barrera.
Mr. Easterling, good afternoon. You know what? I appreciate and support the bids and what you're doing here, but I guess my concern is, how long are we going to prolong this thing? Because some of these streets are dangerous and they do need these enhancements. With your work and you understand how this thing works, when do you think eventually by the time you get somebody that's going to be able to do this work, the people need these enhancements and then it's unsafe out there. By when do you think we'll be able to see something?
Thank you, Councilmember Barrera. So, it's going to be a somewhat slow process. Construction projects don't happen overnight, unfortunately. The industry is seeing a long lead time on a lot of items, specifically poles. So like the larger mast pole or signal poles and mast arm poles you see with traffic signals. Some of these enhancements have those poles. A lot of electrical equipment has a long lead time too. So assuming September 7th when we open bids, we're able to award, there's going to be about a 2 to 3 month process to get the contract signed, the contractor on board. And if we're able to initiate the project right away, we still have like a 7 to 8 month lead time on just getting the equipment. So in all reality, I mean, we'll be working behind the scenes to get the project going, but you're probably looking at least a year until you actually start to see the physical improvements installed.
Yeah, Mr. Easterling, I'm going to give you a layman's novice question here, but what is there anything we can do? Because you know we live in these neighborhoods and we see what happens. We see people instead of walking as a pedestrian, they have to run for their life, and this is no exaggeration. Is there anything that can be done in the meantime, or probably not? Huh? As we're waiting, some kind of safety, something fluorescent, something that shows, hey, this is a crosswalk here. Somebody's gonna be crossing.
Well. The type of improvements that are programmed here are all funded through grant funds, and so we have certain policies and procedures we have to follow. It's not our money,
yeah.
It's federal money, so it's their money, their rules. If we want to do some sort of kind of quick action or quick build in some of these crosswalks, perhaps there's something I can look at with the Public Works Director to see if there's anything we can do in the interim. Mm-hmm. But these improvements that are programmed right now, there's specific policies and procedures we have to follow in order to be eligible to use these funds.
Thank you.
Okay, I have Councilmember Osornio for the same item.
Thank you.
Come on back, Andrew.
Come on back out here. I'll be quick though, okay? I'm seeing here with the discussion topic here, it says that not only were these six uncontrolled crossings that are proposed, but it looks like we're going to be removing a marked crosswalk. Is that correct? So it's Guile Street and Iverson?
Correct.
Did we get any feedback by folks that are in the surrounding areas of maybe not wanting to take that crosswalk, or can you speak to that, please?
Sure. So that crosswalk's located directly in front of a school, and when we were kind of evaluating different locations, what needs to be enhanced, and what would be a good candidate for this grant project, we recognized that with two crossings right next to the schools, ideally we want to actually funnel everyone to one controlled crossing location, enhance that one, make that one the ideal crossing location, and then remove the other uncontrolled ones that are nearby. So any crosswalks that are within 300 feet of an appropriately marked crosswalk, we think that doesn't meet our policy. And the idea is to funnel them to the safest crossing location where drivers can expect most of the crossing demand to occur and where pedestrians have all the amenities installed.
Okay. And so are all of these going to take some time? Because I'm seeing here on East Laurel Drive and Tapadero Street, I could definitely tell you from experience that one is highly, highly, highly used. I know you said that there's not really a timeline, but are all of these categorized in kind of like importance or maybe even traffic?
So once we have a contractor on board, we receive bids, they've given us a price to do all this work, they're going to give us their proposed schedule. Our notice to bidders says that they're going to complete this work within 70 working days, and it's really up to them to kind of deliver the methods and means and how they're going to put it together. We might have some flexibility in the contract. If there's work we can break loose earlier rather than later and waiting on the poles, we will work with them to do that. But we do recognize that there is a long lead time on a lot of the equipment these days. And that the complete project probably won't happen until all the equipment can be furnished and delivered. So we'll work with the contractor, whatever schedule they propose, we'll see if we can break work loose earlier to try to get some improvements completed, but the overall project is gonna take some time.
And is there anything that we can do up here as far as being able to speed up that process?
Not if you can control, supply chains for galvanized steel. I think that's what's holding everything up these days.
All right. Well, thank you so much for answering my questions. I appreciate that. Motion to approve. All right.
Thank you.
Second.
Okay. Motion made by Councilmember Osornio, seconded by Councilmember McShane, ID 326. Call for the vote, please. Oops, excuse me, 325.
Councilmember Barrera?
Yes.
Councilmember Crummings?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Osornio?
Yes.
Councilmember Rocha?
Yes.
Mayor Craig?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay. Last item, ID 326, Councilmember Osornio, elevator modernization at 200 Lincoln Avenue.
Thank you. I'll wait for Mr. Jacobs to be ready.
What can I do for you?
All right, sounds good. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Jacobs. So I just want to make sure that the figures that I'm seeing here for this elevator modernization, I mean, we're looking at $159,125. Knowing that we are going to be investing, I believe, maybe Mr. Barrera can tell me if I'm wrong or not, but $1.3 million to an elevator at the old firehouse. I just want to make sure the $159,125, is that going to be sufficient to fix the issues that this elevator has? Or are we going to come back at some time and say that we didn't look at this properly and now we have to put more money into it?
No, because we actually went to the contractor that actually maintains our elevator and asked for a quote to do the work. And that's why you only see one person on here, the TK elevator. He's the one that's been servicing this elevator for 5 years or more. And he knows the ins and outs and what is actually wrong with it. The reason why it's not $1.5 million is because we already have a shaft, we already have a car, we already have the cables, we have everything in there. It's just a matter of replacing the circuits, replacing the motors, and making sure that it's safe to ride in.
That was my only question. Thank you. Motion to approve.
Second. Okay, motion made by Councilmember Osornio, seconded by Councilmember Cromines. Call for the vote on ID 326.
Councilmember Barrera?
Yes.
Councilmember Cromines?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember McShane?
Yep.
Councilmember Osornio?
Yes.
Councilmember Rocha?
Yes.
Mayor Craig?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Excellent. On to Councilmember reports, appointments, and future agenda items. Please keep them limited to 3 minutes. I'll start to my left, Councilmember McShane.
Sure. I just want to acknowledge Megan and the city manager for their efforts in resolving the Brew In Crew sign dispute.
Yes.
A lot of good lessons learned for all parties involved. Excited for their grand opening the week of the 23rd. Also, I may need a buddy on this. As was reported by KION, August 15th is a deadline for outdoor small businesses that don't fit into the mold of testing centers, vaccination, and or restaurants and bars. So was that an arm for a yes, Christy? Okay, just asking the city manager to suspend it, and if necessary, bring it back to council for an appropriate date to extend it to. Thank you. Last Saturday was the Food and Wine Festival. There's programs in the back of the room for anybody that missed it and would like to pick one up. These are for council members. Pass them down if you don't already have a souvenir program. It was very successful by very many measures. It sold out record number of breweries, wineries. It was just really good. 200 plus volunteers and thousands downtown. Also, just looking for an updated list of future agenda items and presentations. I know there's been some requests, so just trying to get a handle on where we're at. Looking to recognize Monica Abbott when the time's right. She was at the Food and Wine Festival. She's back. She's debating whether she stay in Salinas or go to Kansas City. I hope it's Salinas, and I really hope this council can encourage her to start a softball academy. She's got a lot of ideas. Anyhow, also the Bio Design Challenge. I think that's in the queue. Just really looking forward to that. 26th of August, there's a general plan update community meeting at Sunrise Villa Salinas. Looking forward to that. National Night Out was incredible to Chief Felice and to Chief Vaughn and the staff. Really, really glad I could be a part of that with the Los Olivos Riker Neighborhood Association. Also, there was a downtown public safety meeting that was very well attended, responded to. Mayor, City Manager Kerrigan, Orlando, you were on there. Thank you. Thank you for responding to an uptick in crime. And property crimes, by my observation, are up. It doesn't take a police officer to note that. A lot of calls into Chief Felice. Holy cow, Maple Park's been hit. That one guy was hit twice, his tools and everything. And just, you know, calling on our mayor to maybe make a call to the SVMH board or one of the board members or the chair. It would be a bummer if negotiations stalled. The point made tonight, it was like, oh, wow. Last time that happened, it was really devastating. So really just hoping that that can be looked after. And last, really, really looking forward to a farmer's market that extends to the 300 block. And I know it's maybe not on our staff's part, but if as a result of this call for help, somebody from the city could pick up the phone and call Joel Panzer and see what we could do, that'd be great. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilmember Rocha.
Thank you. I also attended the Food and Wine Festival, and I think it was really well put together, and I thank everyone that played a part in that. I, with sad news, share that my Vision Salinas committee member passed away, Alfred Diaz Infante. So for that reason, I will be postponing my land use committee, my land use general plan meeting tomorrow. Real loss for the city, loss for the affordable housing movement, and you know, I just my prayers go out to his family. I want to thank our city manager for working to resolve the Brew and Crew sign issue. I don't know specifics or anything of sign-related stuff, but those look like really nice signs to me, so I'm glad we were able to make something work out. I want us to hopefully consider the option of allowing people to zoom in during public comment, only because I feel like we're missing a big part of our community when we don't do that. So I'm hoping just consideration for that. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Cromings.
I too was going to mention Alfred Diaz Infante's mm-hmm. passing, and my prayers go out to his family. He was in a fatal car accident yesterday. He has done a lot for our community, for affordable housing specifically, has always supported me and my association greatly. So he will definitely be missed by us at my association. I do want to kindly disagree on the zooming in, simply because and all of the meetings that I go to, I really have an issue with. I don't think that zooming works with in-person meetings. I think that you have to do one or the other. We already have a way for people to communicate through email and watch us on camera. And so, you know, now with us opening up and being in person for the meeting, I think that we're providing the right amount of ways for people to communicate with us. And, you know, I'm concerned of who actually is communicating with us through Zoom, you know, where they're located at, you know, what they're doing. For some of the meetings that I go to, it works really well. For city council, it feels very confusing to me, but that's just a personal opinion. I also wanted to say, as far as fireworks go, you know, we need to think about other options as well. We've got Natividad Creek. I can see when we get our new park at Carr Lake, that would be a wonderful place for a big family event, or even the soccer fields. So we have other options. It doesn't have to be an enclosed place like the Rodeo Grounds. So I want everybody to keep their minds mm-hmm. open when they're looking at that. And I'm happy to be here with all of my fellow council members. Woohoo! Vacation's over.
Ding, ding.
Thank you. Councilmember Gonzalez.
It is nice to be back and to have even more of us on the dais. That is good to see. That is really good to see. I did want to encourage folks to make it out to the District 1 Land Use Workshop at the Breadbox Recreation Center on the 19th. Very much looking forward to that. And echoing fellow council members, thank yous to Steve and to everyone else that was involved in resolving the Bruin Coup issue. Mm-hmm. Marlene works really, really, really hard for that business, so it was nice to see that that was able to be resolved. And a special shout out to Councilmember McShane, because several colleagues of mine had nothing but nice things to say about mm-hmm. yourself and the Salinas Valley Food and Wine Festival, so that was very nice, very, very nice. And as to the issue of the Zoom meeting availability, I understand the trickiness of having to navigate hybrid meeting styles. Believe me, you're talking to a teacher that had to do that over a year and a half. But I do believe that it is necessary for us to, at the very least, offer an option so that folks can tune in and submit some kind of verbal response or some kind of verbal comment online. I think it's an access issue. And even if that means that we have to limit that time more so, if we need to make it succinct, come up with an individual process so that it's not throughout the entire meeting, I think that we have the ability to do that creatively and to find a solution for that. Just another perspective to put on the table. And again, it is good to see all of your faces.
Thank you. Councilmember Pereira?
Yes, Mayor. Closter Park is synonymous to fireworks show. Just putting that out there. Councilmember McShane, thank you for all your community great work. I think you're one of the very few human beings that can be at six places at once. I don't know how you do it, but Rocha's following you, so he. And in the words of Mayor Kimberly, you're a hoot. Chief Felicia, I want to commend you, sir, for the PCAC presentation of this young man's death, young Mr. Martinez. You know us when you face the public on, doesn't matter how serious the issue is. I want to commend you, sir, on your leadership. I really do, because those are not easy things to talk about. But the public needs to hear, whether we feel like telling them or not, it's our service to do that. So thank you for giving the PCAC police community, yes, I get confused with that one, but thank you for that. Mr. Jacobs, the four corners of the city are seeing your blueprint. You got good things going everywhere. Laurel Extension, my God, the way that you guys came up with that little bridge, at first I was wondering how it was gonna be, and man, phenomenal work. You know what I'm excited about? These young mothers in the strollers, now they're gonna have a safe place from the Alisal to go walking, those of that walk to the Nativeda Hospital. Man, that's fantastic. So I wanna thank you for that. Good work, you and your staff are doing good stuff. And also, Madam Mayor, City Manager, and Ms. Hunter, I know as we're talking about housing for homelessness issues and all that, please let's not forget our young professionals. Young people are coming with their masters, there are teachers, there are police officers, they're still living with mom and dad. And these people are not looking for handouts, they're looking, can somebody help me get into a house? I think we need to start looking at that. I know we're putting a lot of effort, a lot of finances on homelessness issues, which is critical. But let's not lose these young professionals because they're gonna go look for somewhere where they can live. We have, I know maybe about a year and a half ago, right before the pandemic, we had a young police officer that came before the council, says, you know what, I'm a professional person, I work for the city, but I can't afford a house. We had two teachers come forward as well. So I think let's look at that. I don't, you're the professionals, but I think we should address that somehow. Also, Madam Mayor, before you close your meeting tonight, let's close it in memory of our good friend Alfred Diaz Infante. Mm-hmm. You know, this man had a vision for this city. And when I heard about this, I've been thinking about his children. Man, this guy loved his children. So Madam Mayor, you know, a lot of times we give to this community, but the family is the one that really is going to be hurting for this young man. And I love this guy, and he did great work. So let's not forget Alfred Diaz Infante. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, Council Member. Council Member Osornio.
Thank you, Mayor. While we talk about folks like Alfred, I also want to echo what Councilmember Barrera is saying, and let's not forget about our housing issues that we face here in the city of Salinas, housing stock, et cetera. We have a really great opportunity with funds that have been coming in, and we should devote some of that money to projects, upcoming projects, to increase our opportunity to have projects done and say, hey, you know what, we have X amount of dollars, you know, and let's see what developers come into the city that currently here that want to work with us. So hopefully we can find some of that and keep pushing for affordable housing, and not even just affordable housing, all types of housing, but definitely our low income, our affordable housing and moderate housing. So I just wanted to invite everybody, our trash disposal on Saturday, August 14th. It's gonna be over at Madison Lane. So let's get out there. If you got some stuff inside the garage you're trying to get rid of, that'll be a great day to do it. A more Salinas event over the weekend was outstanding. Painting benches, painting bike racks, picking up trash, trimming, I mean, it was great. And to see the energy from these volunteers is just, it's phenomenal. And just keep it going. We're onto something now, let's just keep it going. I was over at the breastfeeding awareness walk this past week, and it was a great event. Just knowing that, of course, as many of you know, I have a newborn baby, and I know that these are challenges that women face, and it's real. I can tell. Well, I'll let my wife one day tell the story, but I remember being very happy with her when our baby was finally able to start that process. So we went out there and we supported that event. A shout out to ACE for putting on the virtual Asian Cultural Festival. It was great being a part of it, helping fundraise and things like that. It was awesome. Thank you so much for all the support from all our electeds. Got a tour of the Digital Nest from Jacob. And continuing conversations with Digital Nest on being able to make sure that our students and our young folks here in the city of Salinas have access to Digital Nest. So making sure that the LSL, folks in the LSL have access and having conversations with that. And I enjoyed that. Thank you, Councilman Tony Barrera. And that's it. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a couple of quick updates. I've been attending CASP as a co-chair with Supervisor Alejo. We had the Salinas Valley Chamber of Commerce as a speaker, and also Jose Arriola covered the strategic work plan update. My time on Monterey County Convention and Visitors Bureau continues to work on the hospitality industry and the recovery involved there. Certainly, a lot of our hotels, our residents are employees of the hospitality industry. And so really being active and involved in the recovery of the hospitality industry is important to jobs here in the Salinas Valley. I did want to acknowledge Councilman McShane for coordinating a meeting with Ruth Andreessen, who is the godmother of the city of Salinas. Between the city manager Kerrigan and I, we had a wonderful historical background on Salinas by Mrs. Andreessen. I do want to acknowledge that we did have check-ins with Senator Caballero and Assembly Member Rivas. Both are actively engaged and interested in the policies that are coming forward through the city of Salinas. We have been talking about recycled industrial wastewater, which things I never thought I would need to talk about, we need to talk about, and particularly about saltwater intrusion that's now hitting upwards of Davis Road. So we do need to be very aware of that's coming forward and that we need to be addressing those issues. I did State of the City addresses to our active seniors who are very active and very educated, and I know you're watching at home right now because you hit me with a zillion, 1 hour's worth of questions after the discussion about item such and such on June 24th. And so great work to the active seniors for keeping me on my toes, and also Santa Lucia Rotary. I do want to acknowledge Javier Becerra, our Health and Human Services secretary, visited Salinas with the growers to visit the Growers Shippers Association and Clínica de Salud and the farm worker vaccinations. He lauded the city of Salinas for a 77% vaccination rate. And I want to give a shout out to Sophia Cho, who was my 15-year-old intern who ended her internship. She had a great experience and I think learned quite a bit and is looking to get into municipal government. And lastly, just a California International Air Show meeting between the city manager making the initial introductions, and I think we're looking forward to a great show in October. I do want to acknowledge it certainly was my intent from the beginning to adjourn this meeting in memoriam of Alfred Diaz Infante, who was a longtime affordable housing leader and CEO of Chispa. He was the CEO for 24 years of its 31-year existence. He was also relentlessly committed to bettering Salinas. A quick background, and I'm pulling, just so that I'm not plagiarizing, I'm pulling the information from the Monterey County Weekly. He served in various roles towards furthering his goal of bettering Salinas. Among them, he was a public official serving as Monterey County Planning Commissioner from 1993 to 1998.
and a board member of the Salinas Valley Memorial Healthcare District from 2017 to 2018. He also served in various nonprofit and advocacy leadership roles on the board on the board of various organizations, including the Community Foundation of Monterey County, Monterey Bay Economic Partnership, Big Sur Land Trust, and Hartnell College Foundation. He was involved through his church, Sacred Heart, as a leader of COPA, Communities Organized for Relational Power and Action. In 2015, he was recognized as the Salinas Valley Chamber of Commerce Citizen of the Year, and in 2003, received the CSU Monterey Bay's Distinguished Fellow Award for Community and Public Service. In 2018, after his 10-year board service ended at the Hartnell College Foundation, the Hartnell Foundation honored him with its Outstanding Leadership Award. Diaz Infante was himself a Hartnell graduate. He transferred to CSU Sacramento, where he earned his bachelor's degree and then earned a master's degree in business at UC Berkeley in 1989. He created a scholarship at Hartnell in honor of his immigrant farmworker parents, Luis and Navilia, who made their home in Salinas Valley in 1961. Berkeley Brannon, who has served on the CHISPA board for 6 years, describes Diaz Infante as a great leader. And with that, I'd like a moment of silence and we'll adjourn in his memory. Thank you. This meeting is adjourned.